committee will come to order, and the chair recognizes himself for 3 minutes for the purpose of an opening statement. Today, we are fortunate to vote on a very important piece of legislation in the Targeting Rogue and Opaque Letters Act. This legislation takes on a costly scam that, by many accounts, continues to worsen. Thus far, abusers of the patent system have successfully escaped meaningful punishment. State attorneys general have obtained consent decrees, and so has the Federal Trade Commission, all under provisions of law that the Targeting Rogue and Opaque Letters Act would not disturb. But state laws that authorize civil penalties for bad faith demand letters are on suspect constitutional footing. Regulating the communications about patent rights is unfortunately not as simple as prohibiting certain statements and requiring certain disclosures. It is worth reiterating that demand letters deal with the free speech rights related to a patent, which itself is a right protected from government interference pursuant to the Constitution. We must also be careful not to fix concerns about overly broad patents or litigation costs through the Federal Trade Commission. Such measures are better addressed by other committees of jurisdiction. The very real problem of abusive patent demand letters does compel us to find a solution that is expressly designed to enable enforcement free of constitutional setbacks. Now, I know not everyone agrees with me on this point. I know that several groups are seeking changes to the bill that are based on different interpretations of the constitutional issues. At best, removing the definition of bad faith would give a gigantic grant of authority to the Federal Trade Commission and to state attorneys general to make determinations about the scope of patent law, and that would also invite constitutional challenge. We should be cautious about encouraging state attorneys general or the Federal Trade Commission to construe patents, but the bill does provide key elements that the parties have said that they need to start the process of determining whether a letter is legitimate or not. I should reiterate that the doors of the committee staff remain open. The committee process comes to a close today, but I am hopeful that this is not the end of the process for the Targeting Rogue and Opaque Letters Act. I look forward to working with interested stakeholders on the next steps toward the House floor and beyond. The chair then recognizes Mr. Green of Texas for 3 minutes, sir, for the purposes of an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank our ranking member for holding the hearing today. The Clean Power Plan has raised a number of justifiable concerns, and I'm always glad to debate these issues. While I'd like to find a solution for the issues issued by today's bills, I don't believe the present bill is the correct solution. For more than a decade, the focus of excuse me. You turn that thing off. I like George Strait also. But anyway, for more than a decade, the focus of environmental debate in this committee has been on the greenhouse gas emissions. In that time, we passed two comprehensive bills, while the Environmental Protection Agency has promulgated dozens of rules. Now, I'm not raising Cain with the EPA. The agency backed by the Supreme Court has the authority to regulate greenhouse gases, including carbon. The agency, however, has a different approach to regulating than I think many members of Congress on both sides would prefer. I acknowledge that global climate change issues are difficult and legislation would require compromise, and I think that's what we should be doing, but this bill doesn't accomplish that. Congress should create a regulatory framework for 21st century economy and environment. We should recognize the human activity and impacted the climate, but that doesn't mean regulating sectors of our economy out of existence. Regardless of the public outreach conducted by the agency, regulatory overreach can occur. I don't think allowing each successive administration to prescribe policies that affect so much of our way of life is the correct course of action. We need to recognize that our industries and, more importantly, our workers need time to adjust to new environmental realities and implement changes both technological and educational. I know many of my colleagues agree that our job as legislators should be to ensure that each of our constituencies is equally represented. I prefer that we sit down and craft a bill that addresses the many challenges we face, not only domestically, but as a world leader. Unfortunately, the present bill doesn't address the issues I've laid out in a balanced and complete way. Allowing for endless legal challenges or partisan political discussions is not the proper way to handle an issue that affects the entire scope of the environment and the economy. Today's bill addresses only part of that challenge, the part that directly is in front of us, and I don't agree with the approach. I'd like the opportunity to sit down with my colleagues and draft a fair and comprehensive legislation that reasonably balances the interests of all parties rather than a sector-by-sector approach to the balance that balances none. I want folks in my district to get what they need. I think the opportunity to bring all sides together. I've heard from many different groups, and they all want the same thing, certainty. They want to be certain that our companies will be profitable, that their livelihoods will be protected, and their grandchildren will have a clean environment. We can accomplish these goals, but not with the endless of delay at our agency decree. I want to thank the chair of our subcommittee, Chairman Whitfield, for addressing part of the problem, but let's work together to solve the whole problem. For these reasons, I oppose my bill and urge my colleagues to. Mr. Chairman, I'm over my time. I'd like to place the remainder of my statement on the TROL Act into the record and yield back my time.
The gentleman yields back to the chair. Thanks, the gentleman. The chair reminds members that pursuant to committee rules, all members' opening statements will be made part of the record. For further opening statements, I recognize the vice chairman from Tennessee, Ms. Blackburn, 3 minutes for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am so pleased to see that Mr. Green is a George Strait fan and has such an exciting ringtone on his phone, and I think that's a good thing. Abusive patent letters have become an expensive part of a problem for businesses and for consumers across the country. The tactics cost our economy billions of dollars every year. They stifle innovation, particularly in Tennessee. According to an April 1st, 2015 article in the Tennessean, a record number of patents were issued by the U.S. Patent and Trade Office to Tennessee residents last year. We are very pleased with that. Needless to say, many of those are in the automotive industry, the healthcare informatics industry, and, of course, the entertainment industry, to bring wonderful individuals like Mr. Green great ringtones from great artists like George Strait. The Tennessean article notes that raising capital continues to be a challenge for local startups and innovators. Innovators should be able to focus on getting their businesses off the ground rather than dealing with patent trolls looking to extort money from them. The Targeting Rogue and Opaque Letters Act would crack down on the patent trolls by zeroing in on those persons who engage in a pattern our practice of sending demand letters and who act in bad faith when communicating or failing to communicate information within such correspondence. I thank the chairman, the staff, and other committee members who have worked on this, and yield back my time.
Chair, thanks. The gentlelady. Gentlelady yields back. Chair recognizes Ms. Schakowsky, 3 minutes for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your holding this markup and allowing us to make these opening statements. The Ratepayer Protection Act, I believe, is an irresponsible proposal that would undermine the EPA's clear authority to protect public health and the environment. It should not pass, and I urge my colleagues to oppose it. The TROL Act is an honest attempt to address the issue of patent assertion entities or patent trolls. I'm interested in finding a solution that protects businesses and consumers against patent trolls, and this solution must also recognize the legitimate rights of patent holders to protect their ideas and technology. Unfortunately, the current version of the bill does not appropriately address the issue. I appreciate the manager's amendment offered at the subcommittee markup that closed a glaring loophole, the affirmative defense provision. However, there are a number of remaining issues that must be addressed if this bill is to restrict trolling while allowing inventors to protect against patent infringement. This bill requires the FTC to prove, quote, bad faith, unquote, by showing that the sender of a patent demand letter knowingly made false statements or was aware that the recipient would be deceived. That provision makes the legislation virtually unenforceable. The TROL Act also sets arbitrary caps on penalties for unfair or deceptive practice assertions. I believe the punishment should fit the crime and that the scope of the crime and the ability to pay should be considered in determining fines for violations of this act. This bill also preempts 21 existing state laws that hold patent trolls accountable, including one in my home state of Illinois. In many ways, these state protections exceed those that would be guaranteed under the TROL Act. We should not preempt state laws with a weaker federal standard. I anticipate that amendments to address some of these issues will be offered during tomorrow's markup, and it is my expectation that those amendments will be supported. I look forward to working to improve this legislation to make sure that it adequately addresses the issues of patent trolls. Thank you, and I yield back.
Chair, thanks, gentlelady. Gentlelady yields back. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Kentucky, the subcommittee chairman on the subcommittee on energy. Three minutes for opening statement, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I'm delighted this afternoon to speak in favor of H.R. 2042, the Ratepayer Protection Act that I introduced. I want to thank Morgan Griffin for co-sponsoring it, along with Sanford Bishop and Colin Peterson. This bill is being introduced to try to slow down the extreme and unprecedented regulation of EPA on existing coal plants. When the Clean Air Act was adopted, no one ever imagined that CO2 would be regulated under the Clean Air Act. In fact, there were a couple of votes on it, and it was specifically rejected. But because of a court decision, it is now being regulated by EPA. And because EPA is not a legislative body and is doing it because of a court decision, we in the legislative branch have every right, obligation, and responsibility to come forward with a common sense approach to deal with this extreme regulation. I say extreme because no one ever anticipated that they'd be trying to regulate it under Section 111D. We've had extensive hearings on this. We know that rates will go up dramatically in many states. NERC and others have indicated that reliability is going to be affected. Larry Tribe, a respected constitutional lawyer from Harvard, has said it's the equivalent of burning the Constitution. That's why you're going to see so many lawsuits filed against this. We've had Seminole Power from Florida and elsewhere come up and talk about the loss of stranded assets in the millions of dollars. We see mandates to the states. We see a federal takeover of the electric generating and distribution system, which has never occurred before. And we also know that this is not going to have any effect on the climate. It's not going to reduce climate change. Even the administrator of EPA said that. So we are simply trying to introduce a bill, a common sense bill, that simply says, because this is so extreme, unprecedented, let's allow the courts to render a decision before we take this radical action. We're not repealing the regulation, but let's let the courts render a decision. And I know there are parts of this bill that other people don't like, and Mr. Green from Texas made the comment, let's work with him. Well, I would invite him, and I enjoy working with Mr. Green and Ms. Schakowsky and all of them. But if you don't like the bill, come forth with a proposal and let's sit down and see if we can make it better. I don't think it's extreme to simply say, let's wait, let the courts make the decision, and then let's move forward. With that, I'll yield back the balance of my time.
Chair, thanks, gentlemen. The gentleman yields back. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Barton. 3 minutes for an opening statement, please.
I thank the gentleman from Texas for recognizing me. Mr. Chairman, I have good news and bad news. We have two bills tomorrow that we're going to mark up. Ratepayer Protection Act, which Chairman Whitfield just spoke strongly in favor of, and I echo his statement. I don't think we can improve it, so simply say that I support the Ratepayer Protection Act, and I'm prepared to vote for it tomorrow at the markup. I can't say the same thing about the subcommittee bill that's come out of my good friend Dr. Burgess's subcommittee. I want to be for that. The committee staff statement, you know, describing the bill, I strongly support. But Mr. Chairman, I won't say I've been besieged by telephone calls today, but I have gotten a fair number of calls from my constituents in my district, and I have been in a meeting that the National Realtor Group, the Home Builder Group, the Retail Store Group, the grocery store group all came in and told me in no uncertain terms that they oppose the bill as currently drafted. If I had to vote today, I would vote against that bill, but I'm told that we're going to have a fair and open markup tomorrow, and I will work with you, Mr. Chairman, and the full committee chairman to see if some amendments could be accepted that would improve the bill. I am very troubled. I'm not on your subcommittee, so I'm not as well informed as I should be. But I do think when some of the biggest trade groups that have grassroots organizations like the home builders and the realtors are opposing the subcommittee bill, it's something that we need to pay attention to. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Chair, thanks. The gentleman yields back, and would assure the gentleman that there will be a fair and open markup tomorrow. Seeing no other members seeking time for opening statements, the chair calls up H.R. 2042, the Ratepayer Protection Act, and asks the clerk to report.
H.R. 2042, to allow for judicial review of any final rule addressing carbon dioxide emissions from existing fossil fuel-fired electric utility generating units before requiring compliance with such rule, and to allow states to protect households and businesses from significant adverse effects on electricity, ratepayers, or reliability.
Without objection, the first reading of the bill is dispensed with, and the bill will be open for amendment at any point. So ordered. For the information of members, we are now on H.R. 2042. The committee will reconvene at 10 a.m. tomorrow morning. Remind the members that the chair will give priority recognition to amendments offered on a bipartisan basis, and I look forward to seeing you all tomorrow. Till then, the committee stands adjourned.
You ready?
Yeah.
So the committee will come to order. At the conclusion of opening statements yesterday, the chair called up H.R. 2042, the Ratepayer Protection Act, and the bill was open for amendment at any point. Are there any bipartisan amendments to the bill? Seeing none, are there any other amendments? The answer is yes. Mr. Tomko, do you have an amendment?
Yes, Mr. Chair, I do.
And the clerk will report the title of the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2042, Ratepayer Protection Act of 2015, offered by Mr. Tomko of New York.
And the amendment will be considered as read. And the gentleman will be recognized for 5 minutes in support of his amendment, and the staff will distribute the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have a question for counsel, but I would also be happy to have the chair or the subcommittee chair answer. Under the bill, are there any standards that apply to a governor's decision to opt out of a federal plan?
Mary?
The bill sets out a process for a governor to make a determination, including a consultation with other state officials within the state.
Are there standards in that?
There are not specific standards set forth.
Okay, I know a governor has to make a determination that implementation of the federal plan will cause an adverse ratepayer or reliability impact, but I don't believe, is there a judicial review of that determination?
There are standards set forth for the governor's determination in the legislation.
But is there a judicial review?
There is not an explicit provision triggering judicial review.
Thank you. Well, I believe that, you know, we need to know if there would be a judicial review. Would it be in state or federal court? What standards would apply? Would EPA have to develop a federal plan? Or would a governor be able to make a determination to opt out before EPA developed a federal plan? So with that, I do have that amendment at the desk, and my amendment would make the governor's decision to opt out of a federal plan subject to judicial review. It would also strike Section 2 of the bill, which automatically extends compliance times for the EPA Clean Power Plan by however long litigation takes, regardless of the merits or outcome of the legal challenges. Mr. Chair, the underlying bill allows the governor to opt out.
Yeah. Shh. Gentleman is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The underlying bill allows the governor to opt out of both a state plan and a federal plan. This gives the governor the power to decide that a federal law simply does not apply to his or her state. This provision effectively amends the Clean Air Act and upsets the current federal-state balance, which gives states the flexibility to develop their own plan for reducing carbon emissions, but says that EPA must step in with the federal plan if the state fails or refuses to act. This bill purports to empower a governor to make a determination that implementation of the federal plan would have an adverse impact on ratepayers or reliability. A governor does have to notify EPA of its determination, but EPA is powerless to do a thing about it. In fact, nobody can do anything about it under this legislation. Basically, a governor is given the absolute power to decide that the state does not have to comply with any of the requirements of the Clean Power Plan. So any governor can declare that he or she just doesn't want to follow federal law. What kind of precedent, I would ask, does that set? My amendment aims to make this determination process a little less absolute by making such a determination subject to judicial review. That way, a federal court could decide if the federal implementation plan would have the adverse impact the governor indeed says it would have. EPA and many states are working hard and will continue to work hard to make sure that ratepayers and electric reliability will not experience significant adverse impacts. Under my amendment, if that is the case, then the governor would not be allowed to opt out of the plan unless a court agreed. In offering my amendment, I want to call attention to the fact that this bill gives the governor the ability to opt out of federal law without any checks and balances. This bill truly is a just-say-no bill for states and governors that don't care about taking action on man-made climate change and don't want to actually analyze or respond to EPA's Clean Power Plan. Adoption of my amendment won't fix this bad bill, and so I will continue to oppose it. But I want everyone to understand that even though the language of the bill suggests that a governor would only opt out due to ratepayer reliability impacts, the reality is the language is completely unenforceable. A governor can make such a determination without any analysis, and nobody can do a thing about it. So with that, I yield back and ask support for the amendment.
Madam Chairman.
The gentleman yields back. The gentleman, Kentucky, is recognized.
I would just like to make the comment, the whole purpose of this bill is to provide checks and balance against a very extreme radical action of EPA. And I would like, Mr. Tonko, I'd like to ask you the question, I mean, I don't know the answer, so I'm asking you. Is there a precedence for this action that you're taking in this legislation? Can you give me an example of another situation where a state governor takes action that is deemed a final federal agency action?
I think the actions here are based on technical merit, and I believe that this makes for a situation where judicial review would guarantee that this is just not whim. It's based on analytical quantification, which I think is very important. We're dealing with a technical matter here. It's perhaps unlike other situations.
Well, I would just say that we don't view the EPA as the sole and exclusive domain of scientific evidence or the correct procedural in coming to a conclusion. And we think that governors, through their agencies, have a lot of experts, and this legislation directs them to consult with various agencies of the state government.
If the gentleman would yield?
Yes.
I believe that the impacts of this opting out of one state can have an effect on other states that are addressing their carbon emission situation. So as a national agenda, the impact of state to state here would be severe and perhaps setting back the overall commitment.
But we're not requiring states to opt out or even make a decision that they're adversely affected on their rates and or their reliability. This is such an extreme action by EPA. They, in effect, are shifting ultimate authority for energy planning and decision-making from the states to the federal government, which has never been done before. And so our legislation simply, and furthermore, EPA generally gives states 3 years for state implementation plans. This time, even though it's radical and extreme, they're giving them 13 months. So we're simply saying with this legislation, it's so controversial, let's let the courts render a decision first, and those states, I mean, I'm sure that California is not going to say their rates and reliability is going to be adversely affected, but there are many states who have already filed suit, and this legislation simply gives them an opportunity to respond to a radical, unprecedented action by EPA. And so for that reason, I would respectfully oppose the gentleman's amendment and would yield back. Does anyone else want to?
The gentleman yielding back his time. Is there anyone else that wants to use the balance of that time? If not, the gentleman yields back. Is there anyone else seeking time?
Madam Chairman.
Gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes.
Madam Chairman, I move to strike the last word in support of Mr. Tonkin's amendment.
Gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes.
Madam Chairman, this amendment highlights the true nature of this legislation, which is a little more than a thinly veiled excuse for states to do nothing about climate change. Under the bill, a governor can decide to block EPA from implementing a federal plan to reduce carbon pollution, even if a state has failed to act. A governor is given unrestricted power, which can be used at his own discretion. Though the bill does require the governor to make some cursory determination on the adverse impacts on ratepayers and reliability before opting out, the bill says absolutely nothing about requiring the governor's determination to be based on any factual facts or any analysis. He must consult with various state agencies, but they have absolutely no power to object substantively or to reverse his determination, his or her determination. In fact, nothing in the bill even requires that there be an actual state or federal plan available for review before the governor makes his determination. And if the governor has already determined that the requirements of neither a state nor federal plan should apply to sources in his state, why should the state or EPA go to the trouble of developing a federal plan at all? That itself would be a huge waste of resources. Madam Chairman, this legislation is unnecessary, it's premature, and it would be extremely disruptive to the careful planning process that EPA is developing in cooperation with the states. Any legitimate issue regarding rate or reliability impacts of a state or of a federal plan will be worked out long in advance. That is the job of FERC. That's the job of the states, the RTOs, and the utilities. As witnesses before our subcommittee have testified, implementation of environmental regulations have never been the source of major rate or reliability issues. This rule will be no different, especially given the flexibility and the long-term compliance time frames the Clean Power Plan provides. Therefore, there should be no objections to making a governor's decision to opt out of a federal plan subject to judicial review if there really is a problem, and that then that decision will hold up in court. Governors should not be given unbridled authority to reject the requirements of a federal law. Madam Chairman, I urge all my colleagues to support the Spine Amendment, the Tonko Amendment. I yield back.
The gentleman yields back. Is there a gentleman from Illinois is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and I'll be brief. You know, Lawrence Tribe, you know, said it best in the hearing that, you know, burning the Constitution is not an energy policy. And under the Federal Power Act, states have previously an exclusive jurisdiction over intrastate electricity matters. FERC Commissioner Clark testified that the Clean Power Plan would result in a comprehensive mother-may-I relationship with EPA that has never before existed. This is not cooperative federalism. This is coercive federalism. States, not the EPA, should have the last word when it comes to the affordability and reliability of their electricity systems. I ask my colleagues to vote no on the amendment, and I yield back my time.
Gentleman yields back. Are there others seeking recognition? If there is no further discussion, the vote occurs on the amendment. All those in favor shall signify by saying aye. All those opposed, no. The noes have it. The amendment is not agreed to. Are there other amendments?
Madam Chair, I have an amendment and then this.
The gentleman is recognized. The clerk will report the amendment.
Which number amendment?
03.
Amendment to H.R. 2042, Ratepayer Protection Act of 2015, offered by Mr. Rush of Illinois.
The gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes on his amendment.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, according to the National Climate Assessment, we can either invest now to address the worst impacts of climate change, or we can pay even more dearly in the future with more expensive and costly damages affecting everything from negative health impacts to wear and tear of our infrastructure and water systems, to stressing our national security to the nth degree, up to and including negatively impacting our overall long-term economic growth. Madam Chairman, as part of President Obama's climate action plan to cut carbon pollution and help mitigate the disastrous effects of climate change, the Clean Power Plan will allow the EPA to use its existing authority under the Clean Air Act to control carbon pollution from some of the nation's oldest, dirtiest, and most inefficient power plants. As we know, Madam Chairman, these power plants account for the largest share of greenhouse gases from stationary sources in the country, and they are responsible for about one-third of the total U.S. greenhouse gas emissions, with no current federal limits on the amount of carbon pollution they are allowed to emit. Madam Chairman, the Clean Power Plan seeks to cut carbon emissions by 30% compared with 2005 levels by the year 2030, and it gives states great flexibility when implementing the rule based on their existing utility infrastructure and policies. Madam Chairman, instead of allowing governors to just say no to the Clean Power Plan without any accountability, my amendment simply requires that a governor must certify that within his state, any ratepayer increases associated with implementing a state or federal plan will be greater than any cost associated with responding to extreme weather events associated with human-caused climate change, including increased sea level or flooding, more frequent and intense storms, more frequent and intense wildfires, and or increased drought. Madam Chairman, before we go down this slippery slope and give governors the power to turn back the clocks on cooperative federalism that has been at the heart of a very successful environmental policy structure, we should at least make sure that we include at least a modicum measure of accountability. The fact of the matter is that states and the federal government are already paying for extreme weather events caused by climate change. And we should not allow individual governors to willy-nilly just say no to implementing plans that would help to mitigate the risk of these types of disasters. Madam Chairman, this bill will set dangerous precedent both to the Clean Air Act and to the overall public health if it were ever to be enacted into law. So I urge all my colleagues on both sides of the aisle to support my amendment in order to ensure some sense of accountability and to protect the overall public interest. With that, Madam Chair, I yield back the balance of my time.
The gentleman yields back. Are there others? The gentleman is recognized.
Madam Chairman, thank you so much. I just want the EPA to follow the law. I don't believe they're following the law. And so then we get into these debates that I think are just distracting about all of these different issues that Mr. Rush has raised. Now, this amendment would require certification by state governors that cost to their ratepayers under EPA's 111D rule, which I think they're in violation of the law on, would exceed the cost associated with responding to extreme weather events. Now, that's kind of interesting, because this would require the state governors to make a certification on something that the EPA itself will not and cannot do, which is to show any direct benefits on climate change from their rule under this new Clean Power Plan under Rule 111D. We know from testimony of the EPA itself that 111D rule will not have an impact we can measure on climate events in the United States. Just 2 weeks ago, Acting Assistant Administrator McCabe indicated the EPA could not predict the impact of the rule on any of its climate indicators. That was in testimony in this room. This amendment is merely distracting from the real issues that we are trying to confront today, which are the complexities of the EPA's pending rule, the legality of the EPA's pending rule, and the feasibility of the pending rule. These are real-world impacts on real-world people. While we're playing games with the ratepayers, they are playing games with the law. The risk is great to the ratepayer. Let's at least first figure out whether or not they even have the authority to go forward before we start doing great damage to the ratepayers of the United States. The State Corporation Commission of Virginia estimated that it would be billions of dollars for just one of the providers of electricity in Virginia to comply with this rule. This is a real-world consequence for real-world ratepayers, and maybe the fat cats can afford to pay it, but the folks in my district back home who are struggling now to pay their electric bills can't afford this. And I think that it's a reasonable bill, and I think this amendment just distracts from the real purposes of the bill, and it should be voted, and I urge...
Will the gentleman yield?
I would yield to the gentleman.
Thank you very much. I also want to make a comment. We went back and looked at some of the debates and the records of the discussion of the original Clean Air Act. And there were a couple of occasions when there was a discussion about regulating CO2 under the Clean Air Act. And it was specifically rejected by the Congress. Even former Congressman and Chairman of this committee, John Dingell, talked about it was never intended to regulate CO2 under the Clean Air Act. And we find ourselves in this position today because of the Massachusetts EPA tailpipe decision, which has been now expanded to the rest of our society. So that was a decision. The court didn't say to do it. The court said for EPA to analyze it and make a decision, which they did. But this is so broad and so moving in such an expansive way, an extreme way, a radical way, that Congress needs to make a statement on this issue. And that's what we are attempting to do today. And we're not even in this legislation trying to repeal this regulation. We're simply saying it is so outside the bounds of expectations that we should allow the courts to render a decision before states are put into this position. We know that some states are supporting this, but we know many states are going to be hurt in a dramatic way. Their economy is going to be affected. Their rates are going to go up. Their reliability is going to be challenged. And we're simply saying EPA has never, ever tried to regulate the electric generating and transmission system before. But that's precisely what they're doing in this regulation. And so I would just reiterate what my friend from Virginia stated. EPA itself has said this regulation will not in any way dramatically affect or reduce climate change. And so at a time when the U.S. is taking these extreme actions, we have China announcing they're spending $38 billion to build new coal plants in Pakistan. They're negotiating with India to build up to 400 new coal plants in India. And yet we unilaterally, because of commitments made by this president in international agreements, are putting America at a disadvantage. And so I'll say once again, we're not trying to repeal, just trying to give states additional time. Even EPA normally gives them up to 3 years, and now they're giving them 13 months. So with that, I would respectfully oppose the gentleman's amendment as well.
And thank you, and I yield back.
The gentleman yields back. Ms. Castor is seeking recognition.
Madam Chairman.
5 minutes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Ms. Castor, you're recognized.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I move to strike the last word and speak in favor of the Rush Amendment.
You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. Colleagues, this is a very important amendment because if this Republican bill passes, to consumers and businesses across America, I would say hold on to your wallets because you are going to be asked to bear the increasing cost of the changing climate because this Republican bill says, okay, our formal policy out of the United States Congress in the face of scientific consensus and the changing climate is to do nothing, which is in essence to deny the problem and ignore it. And that is going to be very costly to the United States of America. You may want to get out your calculators because here are the increasing costs on our neighbors back home. Property insurance. With increased extreme weather events, their property insurance bills are going to continue to rise. Whether it's flooding, whether it's tropical storms, tornadoes, droughts, those kinds of things, the consumers and businesses across the country are going to be paying more when it comes to their property insurance. Flood insurance. We had a huge policy debate last year on how we pay for flood insurance in America. We came up with a pretty good compromise, but there are still various, very serious questions of what we're going to do along the coastline of America. And in a state like Florida, where we have an $82 billion tourism industry, we rely on healthy coastlines and beaches that are robust and inviting. And this is going to be, we're going to pay more probably in the future. Property taxes back home. As a member of Congress, we don't deal a lot with property tax issues. But you know what? When salty water begins to intrude into our freshwater drinking supplies, into our aquifers, property taxes are going to rise to pay to protect drinking water supplies, stormwater systems at home. So these things continue to add up. Then what we do deal with here in Congress is increased federal emergency aid when we have these emergency events, whether it's Superstorm Sandy, the drought in California, where I believe my California colleagues can speak directly to it. So this is an important amendment that we so that we consider all of the cost of the changing climate. And I would recommend that this bill be tabled and put away, because otherwise you're just saying to consumers, we're going to ignore it. You're going to bear increased costs. The costs are going to increase year after year after year while we stick our heads in the sand here in Washington. The changing climate cannot be ignored. To do so is to continue to heap huge costs on American families and businesses. So I urge adoption of the Rush Amendment and yield back my time.
The gentlelady yields back. The gentleman is recognized. Mr. Bouchon is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. And I would just like to reiterate to my colleague that just spoke that Administrator McCarthy has acknowledged that there are unlikely to have a meaningful impact on any of the indicators the agency uses to track climate change. So even if you make the assumption that all of the things just described will happen or are true, this has been acknowledged by the EPA that this rule will have no meaningful impact on the indicators the agency uses to track climate change. And I yield back.
The gentleman is yielding back. Are there others seeking recognition? If there is no further discussion, the vote occurs on the amendment. All those in favor shall signify by saying aye.
Roll call, Madam Chair.
The gentleman has asked for a roll call vote. The clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Barton. Mr. Whitfield. Mr. Whitfield votes no. Mr. Shimkus. Mr. Shimkus votes no. Mr. Pitts. Mr. Pitts votes no. Mr. Walden. Mr. Murphy. Mr. Murphy votes no. Mr. Burgess. Mr. Burgess votes no. Mrs. Blackburn. Mrs. Blackburn votes no. Mr. Scalise. Mr. Latta. Mr. Latta votes no. Mrs. McMorris Rogers. Mr. Harper. Mr. Harper votes no. Mr. Lance. Mr. Lance votes no. Mr. Guthrie. Mr. Guthrie votes no. Mr. Olson. Mr. Olson votes no. Mr. McKinley. Mr. McKinley votes no. Mr. Pompeo. Mr. Pompeo votes no. Mr. Kinzinger. Mr. Kinzinger votes no. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Bilirakis. Mr. Bilirakis votes no. Mr. Johnson. Mr. Johnson votes no. Mr. Long.
No.
Mr. Long votes no. Mrs. Elmers. Mr. Bouchon. Mr. Bouchon votes no. Mr. Flores. Mr. Flores votes no. Mrs. Brooks. Mrs. Brooks votes no. Mr. Mullen. Mr. Mullen votes no. Mr. Hudson. Mr. Hudson votes no. Mr. Collins. Mr. Kramer. Mr. Pallone. Mr. Rush.
Aye.
Mr. Rush votes aye. Ms. Eshoo.
Aye.
Ms. Eshoo votes aye. Mr. Engel. Mr. Green. Ms. DeGette. Ms. Capps. Ms. Capps votes aye. Mr. Doyle. Mr. Doyle votes aye. Ms. Schakowsky.
Aye.
Ms. Schakowsky votes aye. Mr. Butterfield. Ms. Matsui. Ms. Castor.
Aye.
Ms. Castor votes aye. Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. Sarbanes votes aye. Mr. McNerney. Mr. McNerney votes aye. Mr. Welsh. Mr. Welsh votes aye. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes aye. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes aye. Mr. Yarmouth. Mr. Yarmouth votes aye. Ms. Clark. Mr. Lobsack. Mr. Lobsack votes aye. Mr. Schrader. Mr. Schrader votes aye. Mr. Kennedy. Mr. Kennedy votes aye. Mr. Cardenas. Mr. Cardenas votes aye. Chairman Upton. Mrs. McMorris Rogers. Mrs. McMorris Rogers votes no.
Mr. Walden?
Mr. Walden votes no.
Mr. Pallone?
Mr. Kramer?
Okay.
Mr. Kramer votes no. Ms. DeGette? Ms. DeGette votes aye.
Pallone?
Pallone votes aye.
Mr. Pallone votes aye.
Butterfield?
Butterfield, yes.
Mr. Butterfield votes aye.
Are there others wishing to vote or change their vote? Clerk will report.
Madam Chairman, on that vote, there were 19 ayes and 26 nays.
The amendment is not agreed to. At this time, we are going to recess for the joint session. We will reconvene as soon as the session is completed. I remind all members we are on H.R. 2042 when we return. We are adjourned.
Amendments, and we've taken care of two amendments, consider two, and so the floor will be open if anyone has an amendment that they'd like to make to the bill. For the purpose of the gentleman from New Jersey, seek recognition.
I have an amendment at the desk, which I think is 06.
Will the clerk report the amendment?
Amendment to H.R. 2042, Ratepayer Protection Act of 2015, offered by Mr. Pallone of New Jersey.
Without objection, the reading of the amendment is dispensed with, and the gentleman from New Jersey is recognized for 5 minutes in support of his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The purpose of my amendment is a simple one. It's to guarantee that the decision to opt out of the Clean Power Plan and any federal implementation plan is one that reflects the people of that state, not just one individual. As currently drafted, the legislation before us puts the decision to opt out of the Clean Power Plan solely in the hands of a single individual in the form of the governor. I think we've already demonstrated that there are no meaningful standards required and no judicial review of any governor's determination and decision to opt out of the Clean Power Plan under this legislation, nor is there any recourse for neighboring or downwind states that are harmed by another state's decision not to comply. But if you and my Republican colleagues are determined to go down that road, let's at least make sure that the decision to ignore the Clean Power Plan is a decision supported by the state as a whole and not just by one individual. And the way to do that is to require that a governor's decision to opt out is supported not by a judge or a federal official, but by that state's own legislature. The premise of my amendment is simple. A governor's decision under this legislation should be ratified by that state's legislature in the form of a law. My amendment is born out of a very real situation we have faced in my home state of New Jersey. In late 2011, Governor Chris Christie was attempting to unilaterally withdraw our state from the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, or REGI, a successful regional mechanism for managing carbon emissions in a cost-effective manner. Governor Christie's actions were taken without the support of the people of New Jersey or the approval of the state legislature in order to advance his own personal agenda. As a result, according to a report last month by the Acadia Center, our state has foregone some $130 million in REGI auction proceeds and could miss out on as much as another $359 million by 2020. This is money our state could desperately use to invest in clean energy, resiliency projects, or any number of other related issues. But we don't have that money, and the decision to forego those hundreds of millions of dollars was made by Governor Christie without even consultation with our legislature, let alone its consent. So that's why I believe that this legislation at least needs to include a check on runaway chief executives. In New Jersey, the legislature is keeping up the fight against what many believe was an unlawful and unilateral decision by Governor Christie to attempt to withdraw from REGI. My amendment is an attempt to make clear that state legislatures across the country, as is the case in my home state, have the opportunity to play an active role in this critical process. My amendment first strikes the dangerous and unnecessary, quote, invitation to endless litigation in Section 2, because there's no need to delay the effective date of a rule when you create a mechanism for opting out of that rule. Next, my amendment simply adds a requirement that once the governor checks the box on the minimal determination required under this legislation, he or she must have that determination ratified by the state's legislature in the form of a law. My amendment doesn't attempt to add any other conditions on the determination. Just ensures that the elected state legislators, as well as the elected chief executive, have the opportunity to play a role in affirming the decision to ignore the Clean Power Plan. And so I urge all of you to consider carefully the dangerous ramifications of vesting so much power in one person, because if you do, you'll see the need to pass my amendment. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back the balance of his time. I recognize myself for 5 minutes to speak on the gentleman's amendment. As the gentleman indicated, this amendment would eliminate the ability of a governor to determine that a state plan would result in significant adverse effects on ratepayers as well as affect the reliability. It would also limit the governor's ability to make a determination regarding a federal plan by requiring any determination be approved by the state legislature. As I had said earlier, we introduced this bill simply because the actions by EPA have been so unprecedented, on top of the fact that no one ever imagined that CO2 would be administered or regulated under the Clean Air Act. And I would like to remind everyone again that a number of lawsuits have been filed by states that are in federal court right now on this regulation. And we don't know, they may be premature, they may not be ripe yet, but 17 state attorney generals have specifically said that EPA is hiding behind a fig leaf of federalism and flexibility while in effect forcing major changes, in other words, mandating changes to the state's administration of electricity consumption and generation. Now, this has never been done before. So with our legislation, the governor is the highest elected office in each state. Our legislation is not trying to repeal the regulation. We're simply providing additional time for the states because, as I had said earlier, generally EPA gives 3 years on these regulations. And this time, this complex, unprecedented regulation, they're giving 13 months to file a state implementation plan. So we want to give the governors the opportunity to look closely at the effect on ratepayers and on reliability. And our legislation does not say governors may, it says governors shall. In other words, they must do an analysis with the state EPA, the state health officials, the state economic groups, the reliability councils that are responsible in that state, and then we don't even mandate that the governor take the action. So I think it's really a reasonable approach, simply giving more time, not repealing, giving the states an opportunity to further analyze and not being rushed into a state implementation plan. And for that reason, although I have great admiration and respect for the gentleman from New Jersey, I would respectfully oppose his amendment. And
Mr. Chairman, could I just ask you to yield for
I'd be happy to yield.
I obviously don't agree with the whole premise of the underlying legislation.
Yes.
But all I'm simply saying is if you do insist that, you know, the state have this power, that it not just be a decision by the governor. And again, because in our state, the governor didn't even consult with the legislature, and we were part of this regional agreement, which is one way of fulfilling the obligations of a clean power plan, and the governor simply opted out of it without even consultation. So I'm saying, given that, even though I don't agree with what you're trying to do with the underlying bill, I still think it makes sense that this not just be a unilateral decision by the governor, but a joint decision in the form of legislation that would be sponsored by the legislature and then signed by the governor. But I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman yields back, and I recognize that Mr. Kramer, do you seek, can I yield you time?
Okay. Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, I spent 10 years as an energy and utility regulator in North Dakota. I was an elected public utilities commissioner. Most states are the commissioners are appointed by governors. But, you know, if you're going to rely on anybody, it would be the governor where the buck stops. This is a representative government, representative democracy, and he or she would consult the experts, as the chairman says and as the bill states. And in my case in North Dakota, I can tell you that the rate making is a very complex science. It involves resource planning. In many cases, you're talking about vertically integrated utilities, multi-jurisdictions within just a distribution utility. You have diversity of resources. You have regional transmission organizations that are responsible for dispatching the grid. This is very complex stuff, and I don't think you want legislators any more than you want, you know, Congress micromanaging these things. You want it to be the people that are the experts that you're going to defer to, and which a governor would defer to in studying the implications of all of this, and can take is in best position and best equipped to take into consideration all the complexities of this rule and other rules. So I you know, again, I respect the ranking member as well, but would certainly oppose this amendment and support the bill.
My time has expired. Does anyone seek recognition to speak on the Pallone Amendment? The chair recognizes a gentleman from California for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I understand your frustration. I believe I understand it. For one thing, you've repeatedly referred to the 13-month as too short, and maybe it is, but if you stick to that, we may get somewhere. The opt-out is what's giving us heartburn on this side, and we're going to fight it. And I think it's going to get fought on the floor. I don't think it's going to get past the White House. This would be something, the time extension might be something we could work with the Republicans on as a suggestion. But, you know, we're just repeating entrenched positions on this, and it's frustrating. It'd be good to find a language that we can agree on. To us, it looks like you're going to try to kill the bill with the opt-out, and it looks like it'll also harm the Clean Air Act, which is a standard that we hand hold a pretty high regard. So I'd ask you to sort of reconsider the basis of this bill and maybe this amendment to give the governor not total authority over the state, but to work with the state legislature might be a good way to start.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yes.
I just wanted to point out, and I guess you guys already know it, but the problem in the case in New Jersey, and I think it might happen elsewhere, is that the state legislature had agreed and a bill was signed into law that had New Jersey join a regional agreement, and that regional agreement would be used by New Jersey and by other states that are part of it to meet the standards that are set forth by the EPA and the Clean Power Plan. And then the governor just unilaterally decided, you know, we're not going to do that anymore. So I understand that the gentleman talked about expertise, but I think that in this case, you know, the legislature decided in their expertise that this was a good way to go. And I think that this is something that should be, if you really believe that this should be a decision that is based on expertise and sort of a consensus, it would make sense to not just let the governor unilaterally, get out of it. That's my whole point. But again, I guess I think I'm belaboring this. So
Would the gentleman yield
yes,
time to me? I'm speaking for myself, but I know many members on our side of the aisle are very much concerned about these time limits. And I personally am telling you that I'd be happy to work with you, Mr. Green, Mr. Pallone, anyone, as we go to the floor, even going to the Rules Committee with you, if we can come together with an amendment that would focus on extending the time for states in some way. Maybe you don't like the way we did it here, but if you all would like to try to get together and come with some language, I personally will sit down with you, will sincerely try to work with you, because I do believe it's a major concern, the time.
Well, thank you. I appreciate the offer, Mr. Chairman, and I'm sure that we'll find a way to work together. Hopefully we'll find something. It's just that the opt-out seems to me to give a bad precedent, follow through on other aspects of the Clean Air Act. So that's really what's giving us a lot of heartburn, in addition to the actual implications. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Anyone on our side of the aisle seek recognition to speak on the Pallone Amendment? Okay. If there's no further discussion, then we will vote on the Pallone Amendment. All in favor of the Pallone Amendment, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? No. No. In the opinion of the chair, the nays have it. The amendment is not agreed to. Are there further amendments to the bill at this time? Okay. For what purpose does the gentleman from Illinois seek recognition?
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment at the desk.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2042, Ratepayer Protection Act of 2015, offered by Mr. Rush of Illinois.
Amendment number 2.
Without objection, the reading of the amendment is dispensed with. And the gentleman from Illinois is recognized for 5 minutes in support of his amendment.
I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, as the U.S. Surgeon General Vivek Murtha noted, in the 2015 National Public Health Week, I quote him, "We know that climate change means higher temperatures overall. It also means longer and hotter heat waves. Higher temperatures can mean worse air in cities and more smog and more ozone. We know that more intense wildfire fires will mean increased smoke in the air. And we know that earlier springs and longer summers mean longer allergy seasons." I end of quote. Additionally, Mr. Chairman, the American Lung Association warns us that the impacts of climate change contribute to respiratory problems, such as asthma attacks, while also leading to heat stroke and to premature deaths. Mr. Chairman, when implemented, the Clean Power Plan will help to reduce carbon pollution by hundreds of millions of tons, decreasing particle pollution, such as sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxides, by hundreds of thousands of tons annually, and help to protect the health of our most vulnerable citizens, such as children, older adults, and lower income and minority communities. Mr. Chairman, instead of simply allowing governors to just say no to the Clean Power Plan, my amendment will require that a governor must certify that withdrawal from a state or federal implementation plan will not have a significant adverse effect on public health inputs, including aborted asthma attacks and heart attacks, as well as fewer hospital admissions and mixed school days and work days. Mr. Chairman, not only do the vast majority of the American people believe that climate change is a serious problem and that the government should take action to address it, but also the overwhelming majority of our nation's doctors, they believe so also. Just last month, a study by the American Thoracic Society found that by a huge margin, most doctors believe that climate change is already negatively impacting their patients' health, with 77% of respondents reporting that increases in air pollution caused by climate change is making their patients' illnesses even more severe, a trend that they add that they expect will steadily increase in the future. These findings are in line with a similar study conducted by the National Medical Association, which last year found that older Americans, low-income communities, and the sick will be all disproportionately impacted by climate change if we fail to act. Mr. Chairman, with 1 in 10 children in this country already suffering from respiratory diseases such as asthma, it is imperative that we act to mitigate the devastating impact of climate change before we start to see even more additional illnesses, injuries, and damages due to severe weather, allergic reactions, and heat-related health issues. Mr. Chairman, we should not allow governors to play politics with the Clean Power Plan at the risk of causing even more harm to the public health. Mr. Chairman, I urge all my colleagues on both sides of the aisle to support this amendment. And with that, I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Indiana for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to clear up some of the information about what was quoted from the American Lung Association. Most of you know I was a thoracic surgeon prior to coming to Congress, and I've reviewed their information extensively, and they're talking about particulate pollution as it relates to disease processes like asthma. And the reality is most of the studies they quote in their particulate information is from has been paid for by left-leaning global warming groups, in fairness. And I've met with the medical director of the American Lung Association. So we're talking about apples and oranges here. And really, that information has no applicability to the bill that we're discussing today. With that, I yield back.
Would the gentleman yield? Would the gentleman yield?
Would the gentleman yield?
I will yield.
Yeah, can you identify those left-wing?
Larry. Yield to Chairman Whitfield.
Yeah. Gentleman yields to the gentleman from Kentucky, Mr. Whitfield.
Would the gentleman yield to the gentleman from Illinois?
Who yields to the gentleman from Illinois?
Sure. I want to make one comment I wanted to make. There's been a lot of discussion about climate change and direct and its effect on health. The point I would make is that the EPA has made it very clear, unequivocally clear, that their regulation would not have any significant impact on reducing climate change. So this bill of ours is certainly not going to do anything to weaken any EPA regulation relating to health. And the mere fact that EPA has acknowledged itself that its regulation is not going to have any significant impact on climate change. If you're saying climate change affects health, then there's no additional reason to do this. And the governors are already required to consult with public health officials. And I would yield back to the gentleman from Indiana if he wants to yield to some other member.
Would the gentleman yield?
Gentleman I'll from yield. Indiana has the time. Gentleman yields to gentleman from Illinois.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with my good friend from California, Mr. McNerney, that we're going to be in entrenchable opposites on this debate, and we'll get through the discussion. But history is also instructive. When the Clean Air Act was passed, it was on four criteria pollutants. One of them was particulate matter, which is what my colleague from Indiana was mentioning. So particulate matter is already regulated under the Clean Air Act. The thing with carbon dioxide is it was based upon the Supreme Court ruling of Massachusetts versus EPA, which then gave the EPA the authority to say, if you can find endangerment to human health, then you could regulate it. That's what they ruled. We have concerns that the EPA, in determining what is endangerment to human health, didn't take specific individual health into consideration, but the health of the world's population and all this other activities, which we think is a pretty big stretch. That's why if the writers and the House members and the president who passed the Clean Air Act wanted it to be enshrined in law that carbon dioxide should be regulated, they would have passed it. It wouldn't have been part of the law. This provision was created by the judicial system and court cases. So now we have the EPA moving further on this, and now they have designed a system that breaks the traditional balance between states and the national government involving the regulation of utilities and pricing and distribution in their states. The testimony we had before this committee or the subcommittee, it's pretty clear that this is illegal, this is unconstitutional. And that's what part of our fight is on this side. We can have that fight in public opinion. We can move legislatively, but the citizens of this country so far have empowered their elected members to in essence, fight against the EPA move into directions that they are not, by statute, passed by a legislative branch signed by the president, are enshrined. So that's part of our fight. I agree with my friend, Mr. McNerney, that I don't think we're going to come to any conclusion. We'll just keep fighting until we have to finally get the end of the vote. So with that, I yield back to my...
I yield back to the
gentleman's
chairman.
Time has expired. Other members wishing to speak? The gentlelady from Florida had asked me first. So gentlelady is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to speak in favor of this other great Rush Amendment. It's very important because the bill before us is the climate change denial bill. It is a real disservice to America. It will heap costs on consumers. It really puts blinders on when it comes to the health of our neighbors. And it's essentially shirks responsibility for addressing the costly impacts of climate change. The bill we are considering today shows that my Republican friend's plan is to just say no, to let our children and grandchildren suffer the effects of climate change. Unfortunately, the Republicans' plan is to stop any meaningful action to reduce harmful carbon pollution from the largest sources in the country. This position is indefensible, and it's costly. You're essentially thumbing your nose at the Clean Air Act, giving states a free pass when they refuse to comply with the requirements of the Clean Power Plan. Under this bill, governors can just opt out from the Clean Air Act. That's very poor public policy. Disregarding the health effects on increased carbon emissions around the globe and in America is especially myopic. The world's leading scientists agree that warming temperatures that stem from human-caused climate change will contribute to more frequent and intense extreme weather events and wildfires. They say that these trends will worsen as the temperatures rise. Scientists tell us that the signs of climate change are already here. That is not news to the Americans who already are experiencing those damaging impacts, like many of my neighbors in the state of Florida. Fortunately, Pope Francis recently announced that he intends to devote a significant amount of time to educating people across the globe on the impacts of climate change. He is particularly concerned with the impacts of displacement of populations and health impacts on children. Just last year, the United States experienced 8 severe weather, flood, and drought events, each causing at least $1 billion in damage across 35 states. Overall, these disasters caused more than $19 billion in damage, and according to OMB, over the past decade, extreme weather and fire alone have cost taxpayers $300 billion. These events have cost us all real money. These examples are just a snapshot of the overwhelming costs that we can expect in the future with exacerbated climate change. That's why this bill of sticking your head in the sand and ignoring it is the wrong way to go. We should be working together to address early the impacts of climate change. Otherwise, we're going to pay a lot more down the road. Mr. Rush's amendment is very important. It's a second amendment that says let's consider the real impacts of climate change rather than just letting states off the hook. You cannot and you should not assume that just saying no to acting on climate will cost nothing. It's said that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, and that's especially true for the cost of our rapidly changing climate. I urge a yes vote on the Rush Amendment and yield the balance of my time to Mr. Rush.
I want to thank the gentlelady from Florida for yielding. Mr. Chairman, my colleagues on the other side of the aisle keep insisting that the EPA has admitted that the Clean Power Plan was nothing to halt the threat of climate change. They are wrong. EPA has made no such admission. If my colleagues on the other side want to keep insisting that they have made such an admission, then I would ask them to produce it in the record. Mr. Chairman, neither EPA Administrator McCarthy nor Assistant Administrator McCabe have made such a ridiculous admission. In fact, the EPA rule makes it clear that it is about climate change, and the EPA has said, and I quote, "Climate change is not just a problem for the future. We are facing its impacts today. Average temperatures have risen in most states since 1901, with seven of the top 10 warmest years on record occurring since 1998. Climate and weather disasters in 2012 cost the American economy more than $100 billion.
The gentlelady's time has expired.
Claim the time.
But
Mr. Chairman, I could move to strike the last word. So
yeah, let me. Yeah, okay. By unanimous consent, I'll give the gentleman another minute.
Power plants are the largest concentrated source of carbon dioxide emissions in the U.S., making up roughly one-third of all domestic greenhouse gas emissions. There are currently no national limits on carbon pollution levels. Nationwide, by 2030, the Clean Power Plan will help cut carbon pollution from the power sector by approximately 30% from the 2005 levels. Mr. Chairman, the EPA has estimated the climate benefits from the Clean Power Plan and its regulatory impact analysis, which was approved by the Office of Management and Budget, indicates that, and I quote, in 2020, this proposal will yield monetized climate benefits of approximately $17 billion relative to the 2020 base case. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Chair would recognize the gentlelady from Washington State, Ms. McMorris Rogers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to speak in opposition to the amendment, and you know, I have a lot of concerns too about the rule coming out of EPA 111D rule, and I have a lot of concerns about the impact it's going to have on my state, the impact that it's going to have, real economic impacts. I come from Washington State, which is actually one of the cleanest, greenest states in the country, the Great Pacific Northwest. We are largely hydropower. We have nuclear. Our one coal plant is actually being phased out. And I've yet to find someone who can explain the formula, because we get asked to reduce our carbon emissions more than any other state in the country. We're at the top of the list. And I believe that it really highlights that the rule is arbitrary, and that we need answers. We need to be working together. We need to be working with the states, and we need to be giving the states more authority as we move forward. So I would urge opposition to this amendment.
Will the gentlelady yield?
I'd be happy to yield to the gentleman from.
We all recognize that EPA has made a lot of comments about climate change and its effect on a lot of different aspects of our atmosphere and every other identifying situation. But Administrator McCarthy acknowledged and has said that the impact of the Clean Power Plan on global temperatures or sea rise levels is so small, EPA has not even measured it. In response to questions for the record, EPA indicated that it did not model these impacts, even though it has done so for other rules. So they did not measure it for these impacts on this regulation. And I remember the gentleman from Kansas, Mr. Pompeo, specifically went through a line of questions with the assistant administrator, I think it was Ms. McCabe, when she was here, asking her directly, would this regulation dramatically impact the reduction of climate change? And she said no, and she said they had not measured it. So I'd like to yield to the gentleman from Kansas if he'd like to make a comment about it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've asked repeatedly with respect to this rule in particular if EPA has any science, any evidence that would indicate how many or which of the EPA's own climate indicators would be impacted by this rule, and if so, if they could tell us how much. And in each case, I was told that they did not. In one case, I was told that actually I wasn't asking the right question. and was told that the truth is this is just about global leadership. So we have been inquiring to try and find the science behind this rule and what true health impacts it will have, and have been unable to get the answers from the agency for many, many months now. And I yield back.
Gentlelady yields back, and the chair would recognize the gentlelady from Illinois, Ms. Jakowski, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was particularly struck by the gentleman from Indiana's remark about left-wing research informing, I guess, the Lung Association.
Will the gentlelady yield?
Yes.
Funded by those organizations, not research done by. There's
okay.
a difference.
Okay.
Thank you.
Even so,
yield back.
Funded by, that somehow, certainly the implication was that it's tainted by these ideological organizations. And the letter that we received then must call into question not only a letter from the American Lung Association, which states very clearly, the undersigned public health and medical organizations urge you to oppose the Ratepayer Protection Act. Far from protecting Americans, this bill would put lives at risk by delaying and blocking critical clean air protections. It's signed by the Allergy and Asthma Network, the American Lung Association, American Public Health Association, American Thoracic Society, Asthma and Allergy Foundation of America, Healthcare Without Harm, National Association of County and City Health Officials, National Association of Hispanic Nurses, Trust for America's Health. And I think that the idea that all of these organizations have somehow been snookered by left-wing funded organizations, that this causes a problem for health. I kind of take this personally because my grandson, has asthma, relies on inhalers. To your point, again, the gentleman from Indiana, it says not only would the Clean Power Plan give states flexible tools to reduce the carbon pollution that causes climate change, these crucial tools would also lower other deadly pollutants at the same time, preventing up to 6,600 premature deaths and 150,000 asthma attacks every year by 2030. So it seems to me that the gentleman's amendment, which would provide a guarantee for me that if my governor, for example, back home in Illinois, decides he wants to delay EPA protections, I would be able to have some sort of guarantee that it would not have an adverse impact on health outcomes in my district or in my family. And I would like to be able to have that guarantee that this amendment would provide. I think that really smearing these organizations of great integrity by questioning their conclusions because of ideology is really out of line. And I am prepared to yield to anybody who on our side who would like to speak to this. Otherwise, then...
Will the gentlelady yield for...
Then I yield back. Oh, yes, I would yield to the gentleman.
The information on potential improvements in health is based on computer modeling. You may or may not know that, not based on actual patient data. And the computer models have been shown to be inaccurate for decades. So there's no actual patient data. And it's referring to particulates, and we can dispute. So we're talking about CO2 today.
I also
so on the particulate side, you know, you can make a fair argument, but on the CO2 side, there's no data to support it, and it's based on these projections on lives saved are based on computer models,
okay,
not
so
on actual patient data.
So reclaiming my time,
so they're flawed.
The gentleman wants to go on record and saying that CO2 pollution has nothing to do with climate or health effects, then so be it. But I think that this is a moment in time when this committee actually has an opportunity to do something to stem the overwhelming climate change that we're seeing. Talk to people in California about today's effect of climate change on the drought, that the rising sea levels, et cetera. I mean, I think at this point in history, for us to be sitting in this committee and arguing that CO2 pollution is questionable, you know, that the computer models are wrong and that there is no effect on climate, is absolutely ridiculous. And I do yield back my time.
Gentlelady yields back. I think we're prepared to vote.
Well, I think, Mr. Rush, if I could just strike the last word and yield some time to Mr. Rush.
Mr. Chairman, I sincerely believe that we are really, this is a new low for this great committee. I mean, I've heard arguments on the other side that are pretty alarming, because they witnesses come before this subcommittee or before this committee, and they come with trying to reach and satisfy the levels of expectation for the American citizens and also members of the committee. And they make certain statements. They're treated fairly rudely in many indications by members of the other side. They ask questions, and before the witness can answer the questions, then they're cut off for all kinds of reason, and they're treated so very, very rudely. But then the same individuals have the gall to come before the full committee here and try to put words in the mouth of the witnesses, words that they didn't say. They twisted the words around, and the record is pretty clear that these words, this revision of what the witnesses actually said, that these revisions don't fully, truly testify to what these witnesses said at the witness table. And I speak directly to Ms. McCartney, or let's go to Mr. Pompeo, and I remember this real clearly. Pompeo, he asked Ms. McCain some questions, and he kept cutting off. And then he indicated, he asked a question. Let's get to health. You talking about asthma. How many fewer asthma cases as a result of clean power plant? Ms. McCain, we predicted there would be thousands of fewer exacerbated asthma. How many? What is the report? What is the study that shows exactly how many asthma, how many fewer asthma? Ms. McCain answered, these predictions are laid out in our regulatory impact analysis. How much more increased snowpack as a result of the clean power plan? Listen to this answer. That is not something that we predicted. And that is not something that you can predict from, and she was cut off. So this is just an indication. I have here Senate testimony with Administrator McCarthy. Same kind of format. So, Mr. Chairman, let us cease to put words and to indicate meaning that our witnesses before this committee did not say and certainly did not mean. Just to buttress our own arguments, let the witnesses' testimony speak for themselves. There is no way that the EPA have said to this committee, to the subcommittee, some of the things that that are being testified or that are being said today, and the quotes that are being quoted. So, Mr. Chairman, I think that we have reached, again, an all-time low. Here we are putting words, revising testimony, and giving certain appearances that are not there as it relates to the position of the EPA on climate change, and I think that we should cease that, and I yield back. Oh, the gentleman, I thank the gentleman for yielding me the time.
I yield back. Thank you.
Gentleman yields back. Roll call is asked. Let me just say, it's my understanding that we are likely to have only one more amendment. It's the expectation that we're going to have votes on the House floor, a series of votes at about 1:15. So my hope is that we roll call vote is asked for here. I'm hoping that we can dispense with, if it is only one more amendment, to, and then get to final and finish this bill prior to votes on the floor. So with that, the debate is ended. The clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Barton. Mr. Whitfield. Mr. Whitfield votes no. Mr. Shimkus. Mr. Shimkus votes no. Mr. Pitts. Mr. Pitts votes no. Mr. Walden. Mr. Walden votes no. Mr. Murphy. Mr. Murphy votes no. Mr. Burgess. Mr. Burgess votes no. Mrs. Blackburn. Mr. Scalise. Mr. Scalise votes no. Mr. Latta. Mr. Latta votes no. Mrs. McMorris Rogers. Mr. Harper. Mr. Harper votes no. Mr. Lance. Mr. Lance votes no. Mr. Guthrie. Mr. Guthrie votes no. Mr. Olson. Mr. McKinley. Mr. McKinley votes no. Mr. Pompeo. Mr. Pompeo votes no. Mr. Kinzinger. Mr. Kinzinger votes no. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Bilirakis. Mr. Bilirakis votes no. Mr. Johnson. Mr. Johnson votes no. Mr. Long.
No.
Mr. Long votes no. Mrs. Elmers. Mrs. Elmers votes no. Mr. Bouchon. Mr. Bouchon votes no. Mr. Flores. Mrs. Brooks. Mrs. Brooks votes no. Mr. Mullen. Mr. Mullen votes no. Mr. Hudson. Mr. Hudson votes no. Mr. Collins. Mr. Collins votes no. Mr. Kramer. Mr. Kramer votes no. Mr. Pallone. Mr. Pallone votes aye. Mr. Rush. Mr. Rush votes aye. Ms. Eshoo. Ms. Eshoo votes aye. Mr. Engel. Mr. Green. Mr. Green votes aye. Ms. DeGette. Ms. DeGette votes aye. Ms. Capps. Ms. Capps votes aye. Mr. Doyle. Mr. Doyle votes aye. Ms. Schakowsky. Ms. Schakowsky votes aye. Mr. Butterfield. Ms. Matsui. Ms. Matsui votes aye. Ms. Castor. Ms. Castor votes aye. Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. Sarbanes votes aye. Mr. McNerney. Mr. McNerney votes aye. Mr. Welsh. Mr. Welsh votes aye. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes aye. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes aye. Mr. Yarmouth. Ms. Clark. Ms. Clark votes aye. Mr. Lobsack. Mr. Lobsack votes aye. Mr. Schrader. Mr. Schrader votes aye. Mr. Kennedy. Mr. Kennedy votes aye. Mr. Cardenas. Mr. Cardenas votes aye. Chairman Upton.
Votes no.
Chairman Upton votes no.
Other members wishing to cast a vote? Gentleman from Texas.
Mr. Olson votes no.
Other members wishing to cast a vote? Seeing none, the clerk will report the tally. Mr. Barton, how does Mr. Barton record it? It's you're an independent thinker.
That's true. Mr. Barton votes no.
Clerk will report the tally.
Mr. Chairman, on that vote, there were 20 ayes and 28 nays.
20 ayes, 28 nays. The amendment is not agreed to. Are there further amendments to the bill? Gentleman from New Jersey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the desk that's
number
05.
05.
Deals directly with climate change.
Clerk will report the title of the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2042, Ratepayer Protection Act of 2015, offered by Mr. Pallone of New Jersey.
And the amendment is considered as read, and the gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes in support of his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My amendment deals directly with the issue of climate change. It's identical to the one recently offered by Senator Bennett and approved during the budget process. It's simple enough, and I quote, "The federal government should promote national security, economic growth, and public health by addressing human-induced climate change through the increased use of clean energy, energy efficiency, and reductions in carbon pollution," unquote. This clear and concise language passed with the support of 7 Republican senators, along with all the Democratic senators, Republican senators like Dean Heller, Mark Kirk, and Rob Portman. It includes the chair of the Senate Energy Committee, Senator Murkowski, who's from Alaska, where the impacts of climate change are undeniable. But let me start by quoting pro-coal Senator Manchin, who said, and I quote, "There's no question that climate change is real and that billions of people have impacted the world's climate. This amendment supports investment in clean energy technology, including advanced fossil energy, and supports energy efficiency, which reduces carbon and while saving consumers money. We can protect the environment for future generations while ensuring that we have affordable
and reliable energy sources today, unquote. Mr. Chairman, I think we should be clear about where members of this esteemed committee stand on the reality of human-induced climate change and whether or not it needs to be addressed. Senators have had to stand up and be counted, and let's do the same here. Some on your side of the aisle have said that they're not climate deniers, and this should be a very easy vote for them. But it would not surprise me if some or all on the Republican side opposed this amendment. Last week it was voted down on party lines in the subcommittee. But let me be clear. This amendment is a simple sense of the Congress. It doesn't change the substance of the bill. It is for anyone who believes in human-induced climate change, regardless of their views on various approaches to deal with the problem. You can vote for this amendment and still oppose the Clean Power Plan, if that's what you want to do. But if you vote against this amendment, it can only mean that you're against any solution to climate change. So thank you, and I yield back.
The gentleman yields back. The chair recognizes a gentleman from Virginia for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, one of the problems with this debate today is that everybody wants to talk about this as if it were a climate change bill. This is not a climate change bill. This is a let's follow the law bill. In 1995, the Clean Air Act was interpreted in regard to 111D by the EPA. Now, understand, 1995, there wasn't some right-wing Republican in charge of the White House or the EPA. That would be the Clinton administration. And they interpreted they couldn't use 111D and use 112 to regulate clean power or any other kind of power in the country. You had to use one or the other. You could choose. Then we flash forward to 2008, and we have the case of New Jersey versus the EPA, 517F3rd 574, in which the court rules this requires vacation of CAMRA's regulations for both new and existing EGUs. EPA promulgated the CAMRA regulations for existing EGUs, that's electric generation units, and CAMRA refers to the Clean Air Mercury Rule. They regulated under Section 111D, but under EPA's own interpretation of the section, it cannot be used to regulate sources listed under Section 112. EPA thus concedes that if EGUs remain listed under 112, they cannot be used to do the CAMRA rule. Further, in 2010, in a Supreme Court case, that case came out of the D.C. Circuit, in the Supreme Court case, the court noted there is an exception. EPA may not employ 7411D, which is what we call 111D, if existing stationary sources of the pollutant in question are regulated under the National Ambient Air Quality Standard Program or the Hazardous Air Pollutants Program 111.12, 7412 as they put it in there, and then they reference the code section. All we're asking is that we give some flexibility to the states to say, hey, if you think there is great harm to your ratepayers, let's wait until after the courts have determined whether the EPA has authority, because frankly, I do not believe they have authority. The Supreme Court's footnoted it. The D.C. Circuit, not appealed by the EPA, D.C. Circuit in 2008 said they can't do it both ways. EPA has now come up with this unique, unusual theory of law that says, oh, we can suddenly change what's been the law for 20 years and come up with something new. It didn't come through Congress. It's just a way we reinterpret it. Ladies and gentlemen, this bill is about following the law. This amendment goes the other direction. It wants to make it everybody think this is a climate change bill. That's not what this bill is. What we're saying is if you're going to ask the states, like my home state of Virginia, to spend just on one of their electric companies $5.5 to $6 billion, according to the Virginia State Corporation Commission, for just one of the power companies to deal with this rule, that's going to be passed on to the ratepayer. The threat to the ratepayer is great, and we need to give the ratepayer some protection here, because the threat from this rule is great to the ratepayer. And, you know, one of the things we talked about a minute ago was with the health concerns. And one of the interesting things about the EPA is they've never looked at what happens when people can't afford their electric bill to their health. I would submit it's negative. They've never put that in the balance. So with that, I would yield to the gentleman from West Virginia.
Gentleman from West Virginia.
Thank you. I don't know that I can do this in a minute and a half, but let me just quickly, was to look at the issues that we've been discussing about health. I'm just curious. Maybe some folks on the other side of the aisle have some superior information or privileged information that we're not have. I've been asking for 4 years from the EPA when they've testified here time and time again. How do you differentiate from the outdoor air quality from indoor air quality, when the EPA itself has said that indoor air quality is probably 100 times worse than our outdoor air quality. And when we look at what the chamber, or excuse me, what the American Lung Association or what other groups have put out, we know the health conditions in our homes and our offices. Keep in mind, we spend 90% of our time indoors. 60% of our time is in our homes. We're confronted with formaldehyde, pesticides, dust mites, pollen. There are so many issues on the inside. I've just simply asked, when we deal with asthma, how do you know that you're getting a problem that has been exacerbated by outdoor air quality when you spend 90% of your time indoors? The American Lung Association supports this concern. Others have done it. The EPA has done it. But yet we continue to fight our outdoor air quality when it's our indoor air quality is where we face our biggest problem. And then I'll just close with the fact that, just keep in mind, as we said during the testimony, if you shut down every...
Gentleman's time has expired. Is Gentleman Yell back?
Would you yield? I'll yield back.
Gentleman Yell's back.
Madam Chair, I'm moving to strike the last word.
You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Madam Chair, I support Ranking Member Pallone's amendment. This amendment could not be more timely because, as demonstrated by the recent poll conducted by the New York Times, Stanford University and the Resources for the Future, an overwhelming majority of Americans, a whopping 81%, believe that climate change is caused by human activity, and a staggering 74% of the Americans believe that the federal government should be doing a substantial amount to combat climate change, both inside our homes and outside of our homes. Mr. Chairman, Madam Chairman, how can this committee of jurisdiction, this committee, possibly act to address what may be the most serious threat to our nation faces if the members who make up this committee cannot even admit that man-made climate change exists and that there is a problem? As elected representatives of the American people, we should be leading on this issue rather than allowing our own parochial interests to cause us to delay and ignore a problem that the overwhelming majority of scientists tell us is happening, that Mother Nature herself is showing us is currently happening, and that the American people themselves know to be happening. Over the past few years, Madam Chairman, we have experienced more and more frequent extreme weather events due to climate change, with disastrous effects being felt in communities all across this nation. In fact, no region has been safe from the impacts of climate change, with almost annual wildfire fires and heat waves in the west and southwest, perennial flooding along the coast, and damaging and costly droughts and crop loss from the west to the plains and to the Midwest. Madam Chairman, just saying no either to climate change or the plans for mitigating the risk of climate change to outside environment, to inside environment, as the Clean Power Plan would do, is not a strategy. Mr. Pallone's amendment is an opportunity for all members to affirm that their belief in human-induced climate change and agree that the government should play a role in the reduction of carbon emissions, no matter what state they come from. This is a simple statement of fact, and it should be an easy vote. Even a majority of the Senate, including 7 Republican senators, and many pro-coal Democratic senators were able to agree to the exact same language that we have before us here today in the Pallone Amendment. Instead of authorizing states to do nothing to reduce harmful carbon emissions, let us come together today and show the American people that we understand that man-made climate change is real, it is happening, and we understand that as leaders, we must do something about it before it is too late. I urge my colleagues to vote in favor of the Pallone Amendment. Should not be a hard vote for those who believe in taking action to fight human-induced climate change. With that, I yield back.
Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back. Chair would recognize gentleman from Kentucky.
I just want to make a couple of comments. First of all, I don't think there's anyone in this room, even on our side of the aisle, that does not acknowledge that there is climate change. We do differ with the president on the priority that he places on it. We think that there are other issues that are more pressing worldwide right now than climate change. And to be truthful, this markup is not about climate change. This markup is about the EPA trying to take direct revolutionary control of the way electricity is produced in America. And we don't need for the government to do much more than it's doing in climate change already. A report to the United Nations in 2014 said that the Obama administration identified 60 federal programs that are working on greenhouse gases and climate change. They reported that they're spending $22 billion in 2013 alone. They intend to spend $77 billion by the year between 2008 and 2013. They have 18 federal agencies involved in climate change-related activities. So it's not that we don't recognize the climate is changing. There's simply a difference in priority. And this legislation is not about climate change. It's about trying to stop EPA taking over the way electricity is produced in America. And with that, I would, unless someone else would, I'd like to yield time to, I hope that you all forgive me for my enthusiastic response there, but I just wanted to say it. So I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back. Chair would recognize the gentlelady from Illinois, Ms. Chikowski, for 5 minutes.
This amendment is really basic. It expresses the sense of Congress that we should promote national security, economic growth, and that we should promote these by addressing the threat of climate change, and including public health. The Pentagon says that climate change poses immediate risks to our national security. The Risky Business Project, co-authored by Republican former Treasury Secretaries Hank Paulson and George Shultz, and former CEO of Cargill, Gregory Page, found that, quote, over time, weather extremes will become the new normal, unquote. And they refer to decimating thousands of miles of coastland, our agricultural sector, and industries from construction to tourism. Scientists are now as certain that global warming is a real man-made threat as they are that cigarettes kill. They are more certain about climate change than they are that vitamins make you healthy or that dioxin in Superfund sites is dangerous. That is what we call consensus. And yet many of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle say the jury is still out. And as I've said before, history will judge climate deniers harshly. And frankly, I say to my friend across the aisle from Kentucky, and those who make climate change and dealing with it a low priority as well, at a time when we can really do something about it. And maybe even worse, your grandchildren will not look kindly on your failure to recognize this threat at a time when we can make this difference. So I think everyone should consider before you put anti-science statements on the permanent record, you ought to rethink your positions. This is an easy vote. I urge my colleagues to support this amendment, and I yield back. And I yield to the gentlewoman from Colorado.
Thank you very much. I just want to point out to Mr. Whitfield's comment, I'm happy to know that our colleagues on the other side of the aisle recognize that climate change exists. And as I read this particular amendment, I don't think it's a very radical amendment. It basically says it's a sense of Congress that we should promote national security, economic growth, and public health by addressing climate change. And I think that's probably why there was bipartisan support for this concept in the Senate, because it is something we should be able to work on across the aisle. We might have different ideas about how we're going to work on climate change, but really, this is something we don't want to get wrong. We should really start working on this now, and I would think something that's a pretty moderate, reasonable sense of Congress would be exactly the way to start. I thank the gentlelady for yielding, and I yield back to Ms. Schakowsky.
Unless there's anyone else, yes, I yield to the gentleman from California.
I thank the gentlewoman. I've listened to the discussion here the better part of today, and I have to tell you, it makes me sad. Why? Because this committee, of all the committees in the Congress, has the broadest, deepest, most powerful jurisdictions to help bring about change and good in our country. And I have to say that I think we're squandering it. I think that we're squandering it. I'm going to dig back and hand out to all of the members, because there are so many new members on the committee on both sides of the aisle, to several years ago when Ed Markey was on the committee and myself, and we did a joint hearing because I had an assignment at the House Intelligence Committee. And so it was energy and commerce and HPSE. And the whole issue was about the climate changing and the impacts, not only in our country, but around the world, and what a national security threat it posed. All of our witnesses were from the military. So I want to pass, I'm going to get that and pass it out. I hope you'll take the time to read it, honestly. And that may be something that helps to open the door of people's minds to start thinking, to have a deeper and broader appreciation that this is our time, this is our generation that has a responsibility for the next one and for whatever years we have left on the face of this earth. We're the stewards of it. But I really think that we need to, maybe we should have some breakout small working sessions where people are not really shouting past one another, and see if we can create a better climate for change within our own committee. So I thank the gentlewoman for yielding.
Gentlelady's time has expired. The other members wishing to speak on the amendment? Seeing none, the vote occurs on the amendment offered by Mr. Pallone. We'll have a roll call vote. Clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Barton. Mr. Barton votes no. Mr. Whitfield. Mr. Whitfield votes no. Mr. Shimkus. Mr. Pitts. Mr. Pitts votes no. Mr. Walden. Mr. Murphy. Mr. Burgess. Mr. Burgess votes no. Mrs. Blackburn. Mrs. Blackburn votes no. Mr. Scalise. Mr. Latta. Mr. Latta votes no. Mrs. McMorris Rogers. Mr. Harper. Mr. Harper votes no. Mr. Lance. Mr. Lance votes no. Mr. Guthrie. Mr. Guthrie votes no. Mr. Olson. Mr. Olson votes no. Mr. McKinley. Mr. McKinley votes no. Mr. Pompeo. Mr. Pompeo votes no. Mr. Kinzinger. Mr. Kinzinger votes no. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Bilirakis. Mr. Bilirakis votes no. Mr. Johnson. Mr. Johnson votes no. Mr. Long. Mr. Long votes no. Mrs. Elmers. Mrs. Elmers. Mrs. Elmers votes no. Mr. Bouchon. Mr. Bouchon votes no. Mr. Flores. Mrs. Brooks. Mrs. Brooks votes no. Mr. Mullen. Mr. Mullen votes no. Mr. Hudson. Mr. Hudson votes no. Mr. Collins. Mr. Collins votes no. Mr. Kramer. Mr. Kramer votes no. Mr. Pallone. Mr. Pallone votes aye. Mr. Rush. Mr. Rush votes aye. Ms. Eshoo. Ms. Eshoo votes aye. Mr. Engel. Mr. Green. Mr. Green votes aye. Ms. DeGette. Ms. DeGette votes aye. Ms. Capps. Ms. Capps votes aye. Mr. Doyle. Mr. Doyle votes aye. Ms. Schakowsky. Ms. Schakowsky votes aye. Mr. Butterfield. Mr. Butterfield votes aye. Ms. Matsui. Ms. Matsui votes aye. Ms. Castor. Ms. Castor votes aye. Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. Sarbanes votes aye. Mr. McNerney. Mr. McNerney votes aye. Mr. Welsh. Mr. Welsh votes aye. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes aye. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes aye. Mr. Yarmouth. Mr. Yarmouth votes aye. Ms. Clark. Ms. Clark votes aye. Mr. Lobsack. Mr. Lobsack votes aye. Mr. Schrader. Mr. Schrader votes aye. Mr. Kennedy. Mr. Kennedy votes aye. Mr. Cardenas. Mr. Cardenas votes aye. Chairman Upton.
Votes no.
Chairman Upton votes
no. Other members wishing to cast a vote, Dr. Murphy.
Mr. Murphy votes no.
Mr. Walden.
Mr. Walden votes no.
Mr. Shimkus.
Mr. Shimkus votes no.
Dr. Murphy, we're going to vote on final in a second. Other members wishing to cast a vote? Seeing none, the clerk will report the tally.
Mr. Chairman, on that vote, there were 23 ayes and 28 nays.
23 ayes, 28 nays. The amendment is not agreed to. Are there further amendments to the bill? Seeing none, the question now occurs on favorably reporting H.R. 2042 to the House. We'll have a roll call vote. All those in favor will say aye. All those opposed say no. And roll call vote. Clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Barton. Mr. Barton votes aye. Mr. Whitfield. Mr. Whitfield votes aye. Mr. Shimkus. Mr. Shimkus votes aye. Mr. Pitts. Mr. Pitts votes aye. Mr. Walden. Mr. Walden votes aye. Mr. Murphy. Mr. Murphy votes aye. Mr. Burgess. Mr. Burgess votes aye. Mrs. Blackburn. Mrs. Blackburn votes aye. Mr. Scalise. Mr. Latta. Mr. Latta votes aye. Mrs. McMorris Rogers. Mr. Harper. Mr. Harper votes aye. Mr. Lance. Mr. Lance votes aye. Mr. Guthrie. Mr. Guthrie votes aye. Mr. Olson. Mr. Olson votes aye. Mr. McKinley. Mr. McKinley votes aye. Mr. Pompeo. Mr. Pompeo votes aye. Mr. Kinzinger. Mr. Kinzinger votes aye. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Griffith votes aye. Mr. Bill Rockus. Mr. Bill Rockus votes aye. Mr. Johnson. Mr. Johnson votes aye. Mr. Long. Mr. Long votes aye. Mrs. Elmers. Mrs. Elmers. Mrs. Elmers votes aye. Mr. Bouchon. Mr. Bouchon votes aye. Mr. Flores. Mrs. Brooks. Mrs. Brooks votes aye. Mr. Mullen. Mr. Mullen votes aye. Mr. Hudson. Mr. Hudson votes aye. Mr. Collins. Mr. Collins votes aye. Mr. Kramer. Mr. Kramer votes aye. Mr. Pallone. Mr. Pallone votes no. Mr. Rush. Mr. Rush votes no. Ms. Eshoo. Ms. Eshoo votes no. Mr. Engel. Mr. Green. Mr. Green votes no. Ms. DeGette. Ms. DeGette votes no. Ms. Capps. Ms. Capps votes no. Mr. Doyle. Mr. Doyle votes no. Ms. Schakowsky. Ms. Schakowsky votes no. Mr. Butterfield. Mr. Butterfield votes no. Ms. Matsui. Ms. Matsui votes no. Ms. Castor. Ms. Castor votes no. Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. Sarbanes votes no. Mr. McNerney. Mr. McNerney votes no. Mr. Welsh. Mr. Welsh votes no. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes no. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes no. Mr. Yarmouth. Mr. Yarmouth votes no. Ms. Clark. Ms. Clark votes no. Mr. Lobsack. Mr. Lobsack votes no. Mr. Schrader. Mr. Schrader votes no. Mr. Kennedy. Mr. Kennedy votes no. Mr. Cardenas. Mr. Cardenas votes no. Chairman Upton.
Votes aye.
Chairman Upton votes aye.
Other members wishing to cast a vote? Seeing none, the clerk will report the tally.
Mr. Chairman, on that vote, there were 28 ayes and 23 nays.
28 ayes, 23 nays. The bill, H.R. 2042, is approved. And without objection, we'll correct the. All right, so it's passed. The chair now calls up H.R. 2045 and asks the clerk to report.
H.R. 2045, to provide that certain bad faith communications in connection with the assertion of a United States patent are unfair or deceptive acts or practices and for other purposes.
And without objection, the first reading of the bill is dispensed with. The bill will be open for amendment at any point. I would note that we are closing on the House floor with speakers, so I think rather than doing an amendment, we'll adjourn and come back after the two votes that we have in the House. So with that, the committee stands adjourned. Okay, we'll reconvene. When we recessed, we called up H.R. 2045, and the clerk reported the title of the bill. And let me ask if there are any bipartisan amendments to the bill. Seeing none, are there any other amendments to the bill? And I would recognize the gentlelady from California as an amendment at the desk.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do have an amendment at the desk. It's Bad Faith 01.
01, the clerk will report the title of the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2045 offered by Ms. Eshoo.
And the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentlelady will be offered 5 minutes in support of her amendment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Patent trolls and the abusive demand letters they represent a very serious threat and a drain. The drain is on our national economy. The threat is the negative impact on innovation. And I commend Representative Burgess for his good faith effort to address this problem, to try and address the problem. And I want to work with him to produce legislation that stops this. The bill that preempts strong state consumer protection laws and leaves loopholes for abusers to exploit them really does not provide the kind of hammer I think that we need to effectively stomp out this well-documented problem. I'm very familiar with it, in my congressional district, which is a Silicon Valley district. Now, the gentleman from Texas and I share a common goal. We want to stop patent trolls and the abusive demand letters that they send. Under the bill's current bad faith requirement, though, the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission, would have to prove would have to prove in court that the sender of an abusive demand letter made knowingly false or knowingly misleading statements, that they made the statements with reckless disregard as to the false or misleading nature of the statements, or made the statements with an awareness of high probability that they were meant to deceive, and the sender intentionally avoided the truth. Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, this is a very, very high evidentiary bar, and it's nearly impossible to meet in many of the demand letter cases we've seen to date. A case in point is the National Association of Realtors. During their testimony before the committee and in an April 23rd letter to the committee, they stated the following. Recipients of demand letters can be harmed by misrepresentations for omissions regardless of whether the party making them knows them to be false or misleading. End of quote. So this amendment aligns the bill with a much tougher standard to address unfair or deceptive acts or practices. Now, many times there are members that don't want something to be tougher. The only way that you're going to put a stop to these abuses of the demand letters is to have the toughest, most enforceable law on the books. So simply put, the vague and deceptive unfair practices of patent trolls, this is something Congress really needs to take very seriously. I mean, they're really putting a severe dent in our economy. This has to stop. Now, the Judiciary Committee has something on patent trolls. We're doing this here. And really, overall, what this means is that we need legislation that provides really effective enforcement. If you don't have effective enforcement, then really, I think that we're wasting our time. And that's not a diminution of the author of the bill, but that section of the bill, I think, is really left wanting. So for all of these reasons, I'm urging my colleagues to support the amendment. I'd be happy to work with Mr. Burgess to really beef up this section. I don't know what the genesis was to make it weaker, but weaker is not going to do. You really need teeth in this thing. And again, what is in the bill sets a very, very high evidentiary bar, which is nearly impossible to meet in so many of the demand letter cases that that we've seen in my office to date and in my district and from other parts of the country as well. So I don't know if anyone would like me to yield them any time, but if not, I yield back, and thank you.
Gentlelady yields back. Other members wishing to speak? Dr. Burgess, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move to strike the requisite number of words to speak in opposition to the amendment. Mr. Chairman, you know, there is a significant body of law that preserves the patent holder's rights to assert their patents in good faith. Imposing a bad faith requirement helps to ensure that the legislation will not be vulnerable to a challenge on First Amendment grounds. We are required here to balance competing interests, and sometimes that is difficult. We have the legitimate interests of patent holders, and we have the recipients of letters from people who are exercising fraud. And the appropriate balance was a bad faith threshold. We don't want to make it harder for legitimate patent holders to protect their federally granted and constitutionally protected property rights. Without the bad faith threshold, those patent holders would live in fear of Federal Trade Commission or a state attorney general taking an action against them for what might amount to a simple mistake. Requiring bad faith is essential to distinguishing bad actors from those who make innocent mistakes or have legitimate reasons for not disclosing certain information enumerated in the bill. Where a letter doesn't meet the bad faith standard because of an innocent mistake or otherwise there is and there is otherwise consumer harm, the FTC can and should use its Section 5 injunctive authority. A bad faith standard does not undermine the bill's effectiveness in targeting truly abusive demand letter practices, and it is expressly reserves existing Federal Trade Commission Section 5 authority to go after any new, false, or deceptive practices that may be used in the future. Standards similar to the bad faith standard used here can be found in Federal Trade Commission cases involving when the officer of a company liable for restitution, the False Claims Act or Fair Credit Reporting Act, bankruptcy, and intentional discrimination in employment, among others. The hard-fought agreement is based on FTC law. The phrase reckless indifference and awareness of the high probability also comes from the world of FTC enforcement. I would emphasize that since the beginning of the year, in fact, I'll go back further, because this bill was heard in a markup last year in the subcommittee. It has been no surprise to anyone that this bill was coming forward. We indeed have had two hearings, one general hearing and one legislative hearing, leading up to the subcommittee markup last week. This information has been out there and available to all stakeholders. Of course, there is willingness on the part of myself and on the part of the committee staff to work in good faith with members who and constituents who feel they have difficulty with this, but we truly believe this is the best way to provide an enforceable standard. And Mr. Chairman, I'll be happy to yield to the gentleman from Virginia.
Thank you. I appreciate you yielding. I have some concerns, as you have just stated, and I was sitting here doing the what if or the put case situation. So if mom invents a gizmo and then she dies leaving children and of maybe even of different fathers, and then you have a battle over the estate, one could send something that misrepresented their interest, but not be doing so in bad faith, but send it thinking that they are the heir to the patent. They could send out a letter. This would make them liable for being a troll in spite of the fact that it was their ancestor that actually invented the gizmo to begin with. I think you have to come up with something. Maybe what you've got now isn't exactly right, but certainly we have to come up with something. And so I would ask that we vote no on the amendment until we have all the language worked out to make sure that we're not stepping on, as Mr. Burgess said, the First Amendment rights, or just the rights of a person who thinks they own the patent and has a legitimate claim maybe to the patent, but finds out that they don't at a later time. I yield back.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
Let me just say is, you know, this is a very complex issue. We all know that. And I'm not convinced that the bill that we have is perfect. but I think we're going to have some time to work on this before it moves ever to the floor. So we're going to be very open with working with different parties, but we're putting our stake in the ground, and we'll continue to work in the probably months ahead to try and get this resolved.
Would the gentleman yield for point of personal privilege?
It's no longer my time, but I'll ask unanimous consent the gentleman get another 2 minutes. And
ask unanimous consent. I want to yield to Congressman Gus Bilirakis of Florida. He has distinguished visitor in the audience, and I'd like him to introduce him.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it very much, Mr. Pardon. It's an honor for me to introduce my father, Congressman Mike Bilirakis, who served on this committee for 22 years, and was the vice chairman of the committee.
Yeah. Thank you.
Welcome, Dad. God bless you.
The good news is he looks just the same. As we all do. Yeah, better. All right, gentlemen's time has expired. And other members wishing to seek time on the amendment, the gentleman from New Jersey is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to speak in support of Ms. Escher's amendment, but let me just say to Mike Bilirakis that your son has very ably continued in your tradition
And I know it mostly because of the Hellenic Caucus, where he continues to champion Hellenic issues. So I just wanted to say that. I also wanted to say, Mr. Chairman, that I appreciated your remarks about Ms. Eshoo's amendment and the possibility of working together with Ms. Eshoo to try to improve the bill. But in the meantime, I wanted to speak in support of the amendment. Multiple stakeholders testified about the problems created by misleading patent assertion letters, which include unjustified demands for licensing fees and threats of costly litigation. And these unfair and deceptive acts by so-called patent trolls can frustrate innovation, and they can burden entities and individuals who purchase or use even the most common kinds of technology, such as bank ATMs, Wi-Fi, or document scanners. This legislation was brought forward to incentivize enforcement against bad actors, but unfortunately, some provisions in the bill may actually hinder the FTC's ability to protect consumers. Currently, the FTC and state attorney generals can bring cases on a finding of deception, and they do not have to collect evidence to prove knowledge or intent. And consumer protection laws focus on the effect of unfair or deceptive acts on the consumer, and consumers can be harmed by misrepresentations regardless of whether the party making the assertions knows that they are false. But this bill would require the FTC and state attorney generals to prove knowledge or intent in addition to proving a violation, and the enforcing agency must collect evidence that proves knowledge or intent. So even in the cases for which it's clear to all that the sender of the letters is a bad actor, the enforcers may not be able to bring a case. The bad faith requirement is a hurdle that almost certainly makes it too difficult for the agency to bring cases, and I think is a disincentive to enforcement. It's not a step forward. Under Ms. Eshoo's amendment, which strikes the bad faith requirement, the burden of proving unfair or deceptive acts is consistent with traditional consumer protections laws. It reflects the recognition that enforcement actions for unfair and deceptive practices and the sending of demand letters are just like every other standard unfair and deceptive practice case. So if we're going to legislate, we must ensure that the legislation is effective, and this amendment would ensure that the TROL Act is effective, and that's why I would urge support for the amendment and also to work to try to correct the problem in the future, as you have suggested. So I yield back unless someone else wants part of my time. Sure, I'll yield to Ms. Eshoo.
Let me just add this to the layer of things that I mentioned in introducing the amendment. We all want to defend patents. If you want strong defense of solid patents, then you want strong enforcement for these bad actors who are the patent trollers and their abusive demand letters. So, you know, I salute anyone that introduces legislation that wants to remedy this. But what's set in the bill, in the underlying bill, is a very weak standard. It's a very weak standard, the bad faith standard. And it sets the bar so high for evidence that it's like having a sieve and you've got really giant holes in it. You pour the spaghetti in the sieve, the noodles come out, not just the water that you're trying to drain out of it. And I don't think that's the intent here from anyone on either side of the aisle. So I congratulate Mr. Burgess for wanting to do something about it. My only intention here is to make it strong enough so that the patent holder is really protected. And I want to place in the record, Mr. Chairman, 1, 2, 3 letters of support here, one from the National Association of Realtors, another United for Patent Reform, and the other the Association for Convenience and, get this, Joe Barton, Petroleum Retailing. How's that? And this United for Patent
Why
Reform.
Why are you calling me out?
Well, no, because you would like it, because it's got petroleum in it. These are your friends. These are your friends. But I just, on a serious note, this coalition includes a cross-section of America's Main Street businesses. They're retailers, restaurants, home builders, grocers, realtors, hotel owners, and convenience store, and some of the country's most well-known technology companies. So this is not a partisan thing. This is, we need a tough standard. And Mr. Chairman, thank you for saying what you said in being willing to work to make the bill the best bill we can put forward. I don't think it is, because I don't think this section is as strong as it can be, but obviously I'll work with you. Thank you.
Time has expired. Other members wishing to speak on the amendment? The gentleman from Texas, Mr. Barton.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and welcome, Mr. Bilirakis. It's good to have you back. With that applause, don't think about running in the primary against your son now. We love you, but we love him, too. He's doing a good job. Mr. Chairman, I was almost prepared to vote for Ms. Eshoo's amendment until she called me out about it. but having said that, I have an amendment to that same issue, that of the six items in her amendment, four of them are in my amendment. So I share the same concerns. The amendment that I am going to offer at the appropriate time in the markup addresses the same issue in a slightly different way, and I think in a slightly better way. But the gentlelady from California has correctly identified one of the imperfections in the subcommittee bill. I'm not on the subcommittee, and I respect the work product of the subcommittee. They have tried to thread the needle, but this issue of bad faith, the groups that are supporting the subcommittee print, by and large, Mr. Chairman, are groups that have legitimate issues with patents, but they are not groups that, to my knowledge, have ever sent one of these mass demand letters. The group that we are trying to help, that actually has the recipient of these demand letters, as you well know, all oppose the current subcommittee print, because in their mind they are not receiving adequate protection against these, I don't want to say frivolous, but these damaging demand letters would be a good word. So I am not going to support the gentlelady's amendment at this time, but I do support what she's attempting to do, and I hope later in the markup to offer an amendment that addresses it, and I will explain at that point in time how it's different and why I think it is slightly better. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I would either yield to you or yield to back to anybody that needs the time.
Anybody wishing the time?
I'll yield to Ms. Schakowsky if she wants to take my time.
I'm happy to, and I thank you for that. I do support the gentlelady's amendment, but I also really support the idea that we may be able to work together to make this better and to address it. The proving knowledge of an intent is very high threshold, as the author of this amendment has said. For example, if there is a failure to include basic and essential information in a demand letter that causes actual harm, well, then it doesn't really matter what the intent of the sender really had in mind. All that matters is that the communication sent from a patent assertion entity misrepresents or falsely states facts that must be included under the bill, which are made very clear. That allows action to be taken against bad actors without having to prove their mindset at the time the demand letters were sent. And, you know, legitimate patent holders should be able to identify themselves and include information related to the patent that it's allegedly been infringed upon. What technology infringes the patent, how the technology infringes the patent, how the patent holder can be contacted to address this issue. Very basic information. It's not a heavy burden for someone who's seeking financial or legal restitution for legitimate patent infringement. So I certainly am going to support the gentlelady's amendment at this time, and hope that at a future time we can work out something that we can all agree on.
Yields back time. Gentleman from Texas yields back. Other members wishing to speak on the amendment? Gentleman from California, Mr. McNerney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, I'm a patent holder, and I want to see the little guy protected. We certainly want to stop or find a way to stop the trolls. They're really wrecking up the system. But I think Ms. Eshoo's amendment and perhaps Mr. Barton's will go a long way in satisfying that need. So I support the amendment, and I yield back.
Chairman yields back. Other members wishing to speak? Seeing none, the vote occurs on the amendment offered by the gentlelady from California. All those in favor say aye. Roll call is asked for. Clerk will call the tally.
Mr. Barton? Mr. Barton votes aye. Mr. Whitfield? Mr. Shimkus? Mr. Pitts? Mr. Pitts votes no. Mr. Walden? Mr. Murphy? Mr. Murphy votes no. Mr. Burgess? Mr. Burgess votes no. Mrs. Blackburn? Mrs. Blackburn votes no. Mr. Scalise? Mr. Latta? Mr. Latta votes no. Mrs. McMorris-Rogers? Mr. Harper? Mr. Harper votes no. Mr. Lance? Mr. Lance votes no. Mr. Guthrie? Mr. Guthrie votes no. Mr. Olson? Mr. Olson votes no. Mr. McKinley? Mr. McKinley votes no. Mr. Pompeo? Mr. Kinzinger? Mr. Kinzinger votes no. Mr. Griffith? Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Bilirakis? Mr. Bilirakis votes no. Mr. Johnson? Mr. Johnson votes no. Mr. Long? Mr. Long votes no. Mrs. Elmers? Mrs. Elmers votes no. Mr. Bouchon? Mr. Bouchon votes no. Mr. Flores? Mr. Flores votes no. Mrs. Brooks? Mrs. Brooks votes no. Mr. Mullen? Mr. Mullen votes no. Mr. Hudson? Mr. Hudson votes no. Mr. Collins? Mr. Collins votes no. Mr. Kramer? Mr. Kramer votes no. Mr. Pallone? Mr. Pallone votes aye. Mr. Rush? Mr. Rush votes aye. Ms. Eshoo? Ms. Eshoo votes aye. Mr. Engel? Mr. Green? Ms. DeGette? Ms. DeGette votes aye. Ms. Capps? Ms. Capps votes aye. Mr. Doyle? Mr. Doyle votes aye. Ms. Schakowsky? Ms. Schakowsky votes aye. Mr. Butterfield? Mr. Butterfield votes aye. Ms. Matsui? Ms. Matsui votes aye. Ms. Castor? Ms. Castor votes aye. Mr. Sarbanes? Mr. Sarbanes votes aye. Mr. McNerney? Mr. McNerney votes aye. Mr. Welch? Mr. Welch votes aye. Mr. Lujan? Mr. Lujan votes aye. Mr. Tonko? Mr. Tonko votes aye. Mr. Yarmouth? Ms. Clark? Ms. Clark votes aye. Mr. Lobsack? Mr. Lobsack votes aye. Mr. Schrader? Mr. Kennedy? Mr. Kennedy votes aye. Mr. Cardenas? Mr. Cardenas votes aye. Chairman Upton?
Votes no.
Chairman Upton votes
no. Other members wishing to cast vote? Mr. Whitfield?
Mr. Whitfield votes no.
Mr. Walden?
Mr. Walden votes no.
Mr. Shimkus?
Mr. Shimkus votes no.
And how is Mr. Barton recorded?
Mr. Barton is recorded as aye.
Mr. Chairman, I have been correctly told, I've been told that I said I would vote no, and I always keep my word, so I want to change to no.
Mr. Barton votes no.
Ms. Kathy McMorris-Rogers?
Mrs. McMorris-Rogers votes no.
Other members wishing to cast a vote? Seeing none, the clerk will report the tally.
Mr. Chairman, on that vote, there were 19 ayes and 29 nays.
19 ayes, 29 nays. The amendment is not agreed to. Are there further amendments to the bill?
Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman from Texas.
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment at the desk. I think it's Barton 14.
Clerk will report the title of the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2045 offered by Mr. Barton of Texas.
And the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes in support of his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This amendment addresses the same issue that Mrs. Eshoo's amendment just addressed. It does in a slightly different way. The issue of bad faith and who bears the burden is at the crux of the disagreement between the proponents of the subcommittee bill and the opponents of the subcommittee bill. The amendment that's now before the full committee is an amendment that was drafted by majority staff and offered to the stakeholders that are in opposition to the bill. They rejected it when it was offered because they felt that it put too high of a burden of proof on the recipients of these demand letters. What this amendment does is take the offer that subcommittee staff, majority staff, made to the stakeholders in opposition and add some language to it that puts the burden of proof in these frivolous demand letters on the sender of the letter. In other words, if I want to send a demand letter claiming infringement of my patent, in that letter, First, I have to tell the truth. Second, I have to show what the infringement is. And I have to believe when I send the letter that what I'm saying is factually correct. If a recipient of the demand letter doesn't believe those are true, they simply alert the FTC, and the FTC has the option of conducting an investigation to determine where the facts are. But the burden of proving there is an infringement is on the sender of the letter. I think if this amendment were to be voted on and accepted, the opposition, which is numerous and growing and includes some of the largest grassroots stakeholders, activist groups in the country, like the realtors and the home builders and the restaurant owners and the credit unions, I could go on and on, I believe that they would go from opposing to supportive. And the people that are currently supporting the bill, Mr. Chairman, are not harmed by this amendment. I had an opportunity to talk to an individual who has numerous patents and who is the director of one of the most prestigious medical research hospitals in the country, and he had a concern about my amendment, but when I explained it and I asked him, have you ever sent a demand letter to 10,000 people? And he said, never. I believe that those that support the current bill would be happy with this. So what I would like to ask, Mr. Chairman, if you and Dr. Burgess, with Mrs. Eshoo and others on the minority side, will agree that if I withdraw this amendment, that there will be a good faith effort to bring the stakeholders from both sides into a meeting where we meet, hear both sides, and try to reach a middle ground that is acceptable to both sides. This is a solvable problem. There is nobody in this committee that supports these troll sending thousands of letters to people with some nebulous claim of patent infringement, hoping that a small percentage will decide to send money and not fight it. We are united in that. I don't claim this amendment I'm offering is perfect, but I do think it goes to improve the subcommittee print, and with your support and Dr. Burgess's and Mr. Pallone's and Mrs. Eshoo's and others, I think we can solve this problem before you take the bill any further. And if you'll make that commitment, I will be more than happy to withdraw the amendment.
Well, if the gentleman will yield, I will make that commitment. I do think that with some time, we can work this out to the satisfaction of most, if not all, of the parties. I commend you and Mrs. Eshoo, too, for your work. I know that even last night you were meeting for hours.
Committee staff voluntarily participated and did an outstanding job.
And we're not quite there yet, but I am certainly led to believe that we have a good amount of time before this bill will reach the floor, which will allow us to work in earnest to find an agreement that all of us, I think, can support and would work to make that germane on the floor and as part of our bill, which is likely to be an amendment on the floor. But absolutely extend my sincere word that we'll work very closely on this, because this is not perfect. I know that, but we've got some time to work on it.
Well, I'd like to see if there's any discussion, but at the appropriate time, I will withdraw.
And maybe would you like to yield your remaining time, of which
a negative time?
Your magic 2 seconds to the gentlelady from California.
One, two. Mine works.
So I look forward to working with Mr. Barton, Mr. Upton, anyone from my side, our ranking member, and see what we can bring back to, you know, to the committee on this, because this is a big problem.
Gentleman withdraw his amendment.
If there's no other discussion, Mr.
Chairman, right. If I could just gentleman from New Jersey is recognized. Strike the last word.
New York, but that's close.
No. I'm going to New Jersey first, and then to you. I see you here, but even though I looked at you, I was listening to Mr. Pallone. Yeah.
Thank you. I just want to associate myself with the remarks that Ms. Eshoo made and with Mr. Barton as well. I do think that even with the Barton Amendment, the way it's set forth, we still have the bad faith requirement, and I'd like to remove that requirement altogether. So, again, I wouldn't have opposed this, but I want members to know that it doesn't resolve, you know, the fundamental issue with the bill. So I still would urge members to vote no on final passage while we're trying to work this out. But I do appreciate the fact, Mr. Chairman, that you and Mr. Barton are going to try to work with us on it. Can I ask the question, though, if we're working this out, why do we need to pass the bill today?
Time will help us.
No, but I'm saying, does it, given that we're all in such good spirits here, why do we need to move the past?
I think that's the Blackburn candy that passed down the
right,
aisle.
I've got more.
Oh, you've got more? Okay. All right. Well, in any case, let's work together. But at this point, obviously, I would encourage members to vote no on final.
Gentleman from New York is recognized.
Yeah, sorry about that mistake. I mean, there's times people think the New York Jets are actually the New York Jets and the New Jersey Jets. So that was part of that confusion there. As the representative of the only New York football team, the Buffalo Bills. But I want to thank the gentleman from Texas for introducing this. I have many of the same concerns, someone that's spent my entire life in the business world. My worry is that the issue of intent, the burden falls on the person who received the demand letter, and to prove intent is a very difficult, if not impossible, hurdle to get across. I'm very happy to hear the chairman agree to try to work through this so that we tighten down a little bit and put the onus where it should be on the person sending the letters and not on the poor innocent victim who is receiving these letters. So again, thank you for acknowledging this is an issue we need to address, and certainly I'd like to put my 2 cents worth in at the right opportunity, and I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Does the gentleman from Texas withdraw his amendment?
Mr. Chairman, I do withdraw the amendment.
Amendment is withdrawn. Are there further amendments to the bill? General Lady from Illinois has an amendment. Schakowsky.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the desk, common_01.
Clerk will report the title of the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2045, offered by Ms. Schakowsky.
And the amendment will be considered as read, and the General Lady is recognized for 5 minutes in support of her amendment.
The draft bill includes a savings clause in Section 4A2 that reflects the intent to preserve state common law and state general consumer protection laws. And I agree with Chairman Burgess that this law should not preempt common law or state consumer protection laws. Here's the problem. The language in the preemption provision itself plainly preempts state common law. The terms, quote, requirement, standard, and other provision having the force and effect of law, unquote, have been held by the U.S. Supreme Court to encompass common law. So these two paragraphs are in direct conflict with each other. I don't think we should be voting on a draft bill that contains inconsistent or actually conflicting language. So unless we correct the language, the preemption provision will, at best, be open for unnecessary litigation and ultimately left to judicial interpretation, which may not reflect the intent of the drafters. Therefore, the amendment I'm offering today simply makes the intent to preserve common law clear. It removes the conflicting language and closes the door for protracted legal battles over the intended scope of the preemption, and we should strive to limit inconsistencies whenever possible. We must ensure that federal legislation does not weaken consumer protections by, I think, unintentionally limiting the state enforcement authority. And I urge all my colleagues to support this amendment.
Does the gentlelady yield back?
I'm sorry, and I yield or to anyone.
Frank, do you want to?
Would the gentlewoman yield to me?
Yes, of course.
I don't want to repeat what Ms. Schakowsky said, but I think that, you know, basically she's correct, and she's saying that the preemption language contradicts the savings clause, and her amendment ensures that the intent, which I believe is the intent to preserve common law and state general consumer protection laws, is preserved. So I would urge my colleagues to join us in supporting this amendment.
Reclaiming my time. In some ways, you could consider this kind of a technical amendment that makes the bill consistent and does what seems to be an idea that's been expressed on both sides of the aisle, that common law should be protected.
The gentleman from Vermont.
I yield back.
Do you want time? Did you want to yield?
I'm sorry. Mr. Welch, did you want time?
Yeah. Thank you. I'll support the amendment. I'm frustrated and disappointed in the bill. This is a problem we all know exists, and here's what has happened. We had two competing groups in here. We had some of the companies that have very valuable patents that they legitimately want to protect. We had a lot of the small guys, including like low-income nonprofits, who are on the receiving end of the patent trolls that are pumped out by, quote, lawyers that operate basically out of shopping centers or in trailers, just kind of reach out and rip off people. And we had to find a balance because the big patent holders with legitimate patent protection requirements don't want to have a standard that will in any way even possibly interfere with what they see as their rights. On the other hand, the patent trolls, without strong legislation, are going to continue to essentially prey on the small companies and the nonprofits. And the question is, where's the balance? And here's the deal. We didn't strike the balance. The big companies, they can protect it. They've got a muscled-up patent department. If one of those shopping center lawyers sends a letter to one of these big companies, they've got a whole operation with really smart lawyers, really well-funded systems, where they're going to crush that patent troll. But if it's a Lincoln Street nonprofit and they get the letter, they're terrified. It's literally somebody making $20,000 a year and volunteering an immense amount of time to help disabled kids, or it's a small business with folks that don't have a patent law operation. So should we have the balance be a little bit more on the side of the little guy, the nonprofit, or are we going to resolve every benefit of the doubt in favor of these companies that, yes, they have legitimate patent protection needs, but they have an enormous capacity to protect them? So I'd like to see us go back to the drawing board on the bill and try to help out the folks in all of our districts who are just getting hammered by patent troll abuse. I yield back.
Gentlelady's time has expired. Other members wishing to speak on the amendment? Dr. Burgess is recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, I do believe the appropriate way to address this issue is at the federal level, and it's to set a national standard that is enforced by the Federal Trade Commission and state attorneys general. This issue epitomizes the impact of interstate commerce on local businesses. A patent assertion entity sending thousands of letters from one location across the country should not be able to hide depending upon which states have passed laws and what standards are set in those laws. We're talking about a federally conferred right created by the Constitution. The effectiveness of existing state laws is still unclear. It is very possible that the federal courts will find that the states are preempted from acting in this space as a result of some previously established legal doctrines. And, Mr. Chairman, if I could, I also want to take a moment, and I know I introduced these at the subcommittee level, but for the benefit of people here at the full committee level, I have letters of support for the underlying bill from the Coalition for 21st Century Patent Reform, the American Conservative Union, the American Intellectual Property Law Association, the Eagle Forum, and the Innovation Alliance, and I would ask unanimous consent that those be inserted in the record.
Gentlemen, yield back.
I ask unanimous consent that these letters...
Without objection.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield back.
Gentlemen, yield back. Other members wishing to speak on the bill? Gentlemen from Washington.
Close enough. Oregon. Would just like to reiterate briefly what Peter Welsh said. You got a conservative blue dog Democrat agreeing with a liberal wild fanatic from Vermont that's on the more passionate side, and I think that speaks volumes. This is something we all wanted to get resolved. Didn't quite happen in the way that some of us would have liked. I appreciate the good efforts. I agree with Mr. Burgess. We need a federal solution to this because it is a federal law. I should have a federal solution to it at the end of the day. But it doesn't quite strike the right balance, and sorry for that. I'd like to work on this bill a little bit more, and I yield back.
Thank the gentleman from the good state of Oregon. Other members wishing to speak, gentleman from New Jersey.
thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to commend Dr. Burgess on all the work that he has done on this bill, and I associate myself with his remarks. It seems to me that a patchwork of state laws is not the most effective way to address this issue. Really, the effectiveness of existing state laws is still unclear. It's quite possible that the federal courts will find that the states are preempted from acting in this space as a result of the Norr-Pennington Doctrine. And if this were to happen, it would leave states only able to act in the event of sham litigation. And that only applies if the patent assertion is objectively baseless. And, of course, this is an extremely high burden to carry and was rejected as a standard by both the FTC and the recipient community very early in our negotiations. It seems to me the 50 state laws with different court interpretations will add expense and complication to an already complicated field, and it has the potential of hurting innovation. Moreover, mistakes, innocent though they might be, will inevitably be made, adding additional costs. I support setting a single national standard that will ensure that we act to stop patent trolls. We are not adding to the compliance burden or confusion for businesses. And, Mr. Chairman, I also note that the Troll Act's preemption clause only preempts common law expressly related to the transmission or contents of communications relating to the assertion of patent rights. I think that this is a good bill. I encourage further discussions, but I shall be supporting it, and I certainly support the tremendous work the chairman of the subcommittee, Dr. Burgess, has done. And finally, Mr. Chairman, I certainly agree with my colleague from the state of New York, Mr. Collins, that the only football team in New York is the Buffalo Bills, and we in New Jersey have two football teams, the Giants and the Jets.
Gentlemen's time is rapidly expiring. Are other members wishing to speak on the amendment? Seeing none, the vote occurs on the amendment. Those in favor will say aye. Roll call is asked for. Clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Barton. Mr. Whitfield. Mr. Shimkus. Mr. Shimkus votes no. Mr. Pitts. Mr. Pitts votes no. Mr. Walden. Mr. Murphy. Mr. Murphy votes no. Mr. Burgess. Mr. Burgess votes no. Mrs. Blackburn. Mrs. Blackburn votes no. Mr. Scalise. Mr. Latta. Mr. Latta votes no. Mrs. McMorris-Rogers. Mrs. McMorris-Rogers votes no. Mr. Harper. Mr. Harper votes no. Mr. Lance. Mr. Lance votes no. Mr. Guthrie. Mr. Olson. Mr. Olson votes no. Mr. McKinley. Mr. McKinley votes no. Mr. Pompeo. Mr. Kinzinger. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Bilirakis. Mr. Bilirakis votes no. Mr. Johnson. Mr. Johnson. Mr. Johnson votes no. Mr. Long. Mr. Long votes no. Mrs. Elmers. Mrs. Elmers votes no. Mr. Bouchon. Mr. Bouchon votes no. Mr. Flores. Mr. Flores votes no. Mrs. Brooks. Mrs. Brooks votes no. Mr. Mullen. Mr. Mullen votes no. Mr. Hudson. Mr. Collins. Mr. Collins votes no. Mr. Kramer. Mr. Kramer votes no. Mr. Pallone. Mr. Pallone votes aye. Mr. Rush. Mr. Rush votes aye. Ms. Eshoo. Ms. Eshoo votes aye. Mr. Engel. Mr. Green. Mr. Green votes aye. Mr. Gett. Mr. Gett votes aye. Ms. Capps. Ms. Capps votes aye. Mr. Doyle. Mr. Doyle votes aye. Ms. Schakowsky. Ms. Schakowsky votes aye. Mr. Butterfield. Mr. Butterfield votes aye. Ms. Matsui. Ms. Matsui votes aye. Ms. Castor. Ms. Castor votes aye. Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. McNerney. Mr. McNerney votes aye. Mr. Welch. Mr. Welch votes aye. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes aye. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Yarmouth. Ms. Clark. Ms. Clark votes aye. Mr. Lobsack. Mr. Lobsack votes aye. Mr. Schrader. Mr. Schrader votes aye. Mr. Kennedy. Mr. Kennedy votes aye. Mr. Cardenas. Mr. Cardenas votes aye. Chairman Upton. Chairman Upton votes no.
Other members wishing to vote? Gentleman from Maryland, Mr. Sarbanes.
Mr. Sarbanes votes aye.
Gentleman, Mr. Guthrie.
Mr. Guthrie votes no.
Mr. Walden.
Mr. Walden votes no.
Mr. Kinzinger.
Mr. Kinzinger votes no.
Mr. Whitfield.
Mr. Whitfield votes no.
Other members wishing to cast a vote? Mr. Tomko.
Mr. Tomko votes aye.
Other members? Seeing Mr. Barton. How does Mr. Barton vote? No. Mr. Barton votes no.
Mr. Barton votes no.
The clerk will report the tally. She's tallying up. I think that was the last amendment, so we'll go right to final and roll call, right? Yep. Oh, Mr. Hudson. Mr. Hudson votes no.
Mr. Hudson votes no. Mr. Chairman, on that vote, there were 21 ayes and 29 nays.
21 ayes, 29 nays. The amendment is not agreed to. Are there further amendments to the bill? Seeing none, the question now occurs on favorably reporting H.R. 2045 to the House. We'll have a roll call vote. All those in favor will say aye. Those opposed say no. The clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Barton. Aye. Mr. Barton votes aye. Mr. Whitfield. Mr. Whitfield votes aye. Mr. Shimkus. Mr. Shimkus votes aye. Mr. Pitts. Mr. Pitts votes aye. Mr. Walden. Mr. Walden votes aye. Mr. Murphy. Mr. Murphy votes aye. Mr. Burgess. Mr. Burgess votes aye. Mrs. Blackburn. Mrs. Blackburn votes aye. Mr. Scalise. Mr. Latta. Mr. Latta votes aye. Mrs. McMorris Rogers. Mrs. McMorris Rogers votes aye. Mr. Harper. Mr. Harper votes aye. Mr. Lance. Mr. Lance votes aye. Mr. Guthrie. Mr. Guthrie votes aye. Mr. Olson. Mr. Olson votes aye. Mr. McKinley. Mr. McKinley votes aye. Mr. Pompeo. Mr. Kinzinger. Mr. Kinzinger votes aye. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Griffith votes aye. Mr. Bill Rockus. Mr. Bill Rockus votes aye. Mr. Johnson. Mr. Johnson votes aye. Mr. Long. Mr. Long. Mr. Long votes aye. Mrs. Elmers. Mrs. Elmers votes aye. Mr. Bouchon. Mr. Bouchon votes aye. Mr. Flores. Mr. Flores votes aye. Mrs. Brooks. Mrs. Brooks votes aye. Mr. Mullen. Mr. Mullen votes aye. Mr. Hudson. Mr. Hudson votes aye. Mr. Collins. Mr. Collins votes aye. Mr. Kramer. Mr. Kramer votes aye. Mr. Pallone. Mr. Pallone votes no. Mr. Rush. Mr. Rush votes no. Ms. Eshoo. Ms. Eshoo votes no. Mr. Engel. Mr. Engel votes no. Mr. Green. Mr. Green votes no. Mr. Gett. Mr. Gett votes no. Ms. Capps. Ms. Capps votes no. Mr. Doyle. Mr. Doyle votes no. Ms. Schakowsky. Ms. Schakowsky votes no. Mr. Butterfield. Mr. Butterfield votes no. Ms. Matsui. Ms. Matsui votes no. Ms. Castor. Ms. Castor votes no. Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. Sarbanes votes no. Mr. McNerney. Mr. McNerney votes no. Mr. Welch. Mr. Welch votes no. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes no. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes no. Mr. Yarmouth. Ms. Clark. Ms. Clark votes no. Mr. Lobsack. Mr. Lobsack votes no. Mr. Schrader. Mr. Schrader votes no. Mr. Kennedy. Mr. Kennedy votes no. Mr. Cardenas. Mr. Cardenas votes no. Chairman Upton.
Votes aye.
Chairman Upton votes aye.
Other members wishing to cast a vote? Mr. Scalise.
Mr. Scalise. Mr. Scalise votes aye.
Other members wishing to cast a vote? Seeing none, the clerk will report the tally.
Mr. Chairman, on that vote, there were 30 ayes and 22 nays.
30 ayes, 22 nays. The bill is favorably reported, and without objection, staff is authorized to make technical and conforming changes to the bills reported by the committee today. So ordered. pursuant to House Rule 1121, all members will be given 2 calendar days to file written and signed views for the bills approved by the committee today. Without objection, the committee stands adjourned.